Okay, guys, we're ready to go.
So when I draw here, right? Mm-hmm. Like that. Hey, John, come on, can you put this on the table?
Yeah.
And you.
Wants us to get closer. Okay, welcome. My name is Dave Master. I'm the Labonte Chair here at Cal Poly University. We're really pleased to have a guest today, Chen Yi Chang, who is a character designer and supervisor, most known for his work on Mulan. And he's also worked on Tarzan, Batman, when he was at Warner Brothers, and also Atlantis. And what Chen Yi is going to talk about today is what it takes to be a character designer, what character designers do, and what it takes if you would like to move into this field as an aspiration. He's going to go over what is in his portfolio and go through the whole process of what character designers do. We have a worldwide audience. We actually have people on 7 continents who are tuning in on their computers right now, as far away as New Zealand, beautiful place on the other side of the planet, and in Estonia, in Portugal, and a lot of friends that we've made around the world who are now tuning in. And they're going to be able to actually type in questions as we go through, if they have any. We would love it if, when you type in a question, you could tell us at least what country you're from and what your name is, so that Chen Yi can talk back to you personally. And we really appreciate any of the questions you can give us. We would like to test this system out and be able to do this in the future with more artists. Chen Yi is our first attempt at doing this. And we would also love your comments about how the reception was, and whether or not there are things you would like us to do in the future that might make this a better experience for you as a person seeing it on your computer screen. So if there are any suggestions that you have, we would love it if you emailed them to us and let us know. My email address here at the college is dhmaster@csupomona.edu. And if there are any comments you would like to make or any suggestions, we would appreciate you forwarding those to us. The address to make comments is now on the screen, is Yahoo Instant Messenger, and is Chen Yi Chat. And all you have to do is get on Yahoo Instant Messenger and then type in Chen Yi Chat, and we can start taking any questions you have. The first hour of the presentation or so is going to be Chen Yi talking about his history and a little bit about what he does as an artist and what he would suggest that you do and what his feelings are for the future. What are the things you need to concentrate on as a learner and a student? After that, we will entertain questions. So that's the format. So I'm going to turn it over to Chen Yi, and I want to ahead of time thank him for spending the time today. He's been here for a couple of hours working with our students on ACME, our ACME program, and actually went over all of their character designs today. Has spent two hours going over all of their work, and this is an added benefit where we can get out to more people. If you're interested in finding more about ACME, the ACME program, the website is ACME, A-C-M-E, animation.org, and you can find out about that. So I'm going to turn it over to Chen Yi. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Should I start now?
Yes, go
ahead. Okay. And actually, I did some refinement of the, you know, the program today a little bit. Actually, instead of talking about me personally, I think it would be
more helpful to you guys if I talk about my thought. And then if you guys are interested in me, then you can ask me question, you know, some personal questions afterwards. So yeah, today, yeah, basically I'm, you know, I just organized some of my thoughts, you know, doing character design and to share my experience with you, and hopefully that's helpful to you guys, you know, to pursue, you know, for pursuing your career in the industry. And again, my name is Chen Yi Chang, and since English is my second language, again, I got accent, and sometimes I don't pronounce words correctly. So if you don't understand what I'm talking about, please let me know, and I'll make sure that you understand. And it's good for you, and it's good for me too. Okay? And yeah, I'm from Taiwan originally, and I always loved to draw, you know, since a kid. Just like a lot of you, I think. You know, I wasn't like encouraged my parents to do so, because, you know, they always say, oh, art is going to starve, right? Probably your parents say the same thing to you. But after, you know, I graduated from the National Institute of Technology in Taipei, I decided, you know, I got to do something for myself. I got to live my life. So I give a diploma to my parents and saying, okay, now this is yours, and then I'm going to do mine. And so I went to Cal Arts and for 3 years, and I really learned a lot from my peers and also from the teachers. And I'm so glad that today I'm doing, you know, the opposite role, and then hopefully, you know, to share my experience with you today. And so that's a short history about me. So, okay, before we get into character design, currently I'm working at Disney, but I have to tell you honestly, you know, since I was young, you know, until this moment, I still have this, how do you call it, this love and hate relationship with Disney. When I was a kid, you know, probably just like, you know, a lot of other kids, we all love Disney movies, you know, they're great and family value, and we enjoy the, you know, the comedy in it. But then when I was in my late teens and early 20s, I fell in love with those animated shorts from Eastern Europe, you know, especially those ones from Zagreb. I don't know if you guys heard of it. If you don't, I recommend you, you know, check them out. Very inspiring. You know, those animated shorts that has a strong sense of personal point of view. It could be political, could be social, and then that made me realize that animation could be so powerful. It's not necessary for children. It could be very, very influential, you know, for like philosophical thinking or like social criticism. And obviously those, you know, Eastern European artists did really have, you know, their take on it. And so it was very inspiring. And then at that time I really hate Disney, because I thought, oh, it's just, or maybe it could be just my age at that time. And then when I started to reach my 30s, and I started to love Disney again, maybe I'm getting older now. And I just thought, yeah, even though it's kind of limited, but that strong sense of, you know, family value, and also it's broad, how do you say it, the reach, you know, to the people. It's really a powerful medium. And then I thought I might be able to do something in it, and to maybe do something, you know, great about it, you know, and then, and hopefully that would, I would see my influence, you know, to, you know, a great majority of the audience, instead of doing an independent film that only, you know, maybe a couple of people saw it, you know. So I just love Disney again. And then, you know, after so many years working at Disney, I started to feel, oh my God, you know, now I start to get into the hate stage again. So hopefully pretty soon I'll love it again. So yeah, so I guess, and also I like to talk, yeah, just a, how do you call it, a disclaimer. You know, this note I'm going to give, it's my experience working at Disney and in the commercial industry. And I don't claim that it can apply to any filmmaking, but I can tell you that it works all the time in the commercial world. and this is my thought. And so the genre is pretty limited. Okay, it's for character animation, and it is for cell animation system. And so I make it so specific so I can really talk about it. Otherwise, it's so open, then there's no rules in what I'm going to talk about, right? So, yeah, because you know we all know animation has covered a lot of different medium. You know, you can do cinemation, you can do cutout, claymation. You know, there's so many kinds, and they all have their sense of like design in that fit to their medium, and we. And today, my notes cover, I would say, it works mostly for the cell system, you know, that anything that you draw on a piece of paper doesn't have to be cell, you know, anything that is flat. So, but I believe that it also works pretty well to, you know, other medium, because I'm not very familiar, even though my experience, I used to be an experimental animator myself, you know, so I had done claymation, sand animation. So I kind of know them, but since I never spent like decades working on them, I think it works, but I would reserve that this opinion. But anyway, so let's show the first picture. Who's going to do this for me? Oh, I'll just do this. So first, I would like to just give you. I think you probably all know this. I'll just give you an overview of the production system at Disney, feature animation, especially for feature, you know, full length, you know, picture making. The process here. Wait, how do I get this stuff?
You want to go to your CD?
Where is it? Where should I go?
Okay.
No, that's not mine. It's not that folder. How do I go to desktop? Or go to the hard disk? What?
Click it. Go to my computer. You want to go to your CD, right?
Yeah, my CD.
Click down, click.
Yes.
And go to, there you go.
Okay, here we go.
And, you want to open up with that program, correct? Or you want to open up individually?
Oh, with that program. Yeah, I'll first, you know, that just that you get familiar with the system, and I'll just go very quickly so you get a rough idea. And yeah, today, if you guys feel that there's, you know, the information is a bit too much, overwhelming, don't worry about it. You know, it's like, how should I put it? It's like, you know, learning to drive a car. In the beginning, when you're driving, you're so conscious about little things, you know, where the wipers and the button for the wipers are and where is the clutch. But, you know, after you're driving for a while, then it becomes your second nature. You just do it without thinking. Drawing is very much the same thing. There's a lot of things I'm going to talk about. You might feel, oh, no, I'm not going to do that. It's just too much to think about. But actually, once you, you know, keep doing it, it becomes part of you. You just do it without, you don't even have to think about it. So. Okay, so can we show the picture now? The first slide? Yeah, this is a chart I put together. This is pretty much what we do. Okay, I guess I need to zoom in a little bit, just for this one. Oops, did I just ruin it? Wait, how do I get to the menu bar? And could I get that magnifier so I, because it's hard to read now. Or you can see the cursor. I'll just, you know what? It's okay. I'll just talk through it. You know, usually it start with idea, and the idea, this is ideas. Hopefully you can read. Idea comes from, you know, four different channels. Okay, the first one is executive decisions. You know, like Lion King would be a good example. You know, Michael Eisner one day came out this fancy saying that, when I was a kid, Bambi, you know, moved me so much. We should do Bambi again. But this time, let's put it in Africa and with a lion. And that's how it started. Okay, that's the executive decision. Second one is Gangshou. Gangshou is it's occasion that I believe it's held like twice a year or once a year. In which Disney artists, in-house artists, were invited into this event. You pitch your ideas, and then they will listen to you, and you can tell them how great this movie is going to be, and if they like the idea, then that's how it goes. And then the third one is creative executives. I guess we have about 10 people working with producers, that their job is to re-script, get ideas or find children's book or illustrated books that they thought is very interesting. And so that's one source. And the third one is agency. That is for mostly for the outsiders. Like you guys, if you got an idea and you think that Disney should make a feature, then get an agent and then pitch it to Disney. Yeah, Disney will never talk to you directly because there's some legal issue get involved. Okay, that's where we get an idea. Okay, after the idea, rough idea, like Lion King, just okay, put Bambi in Africa, okay? But that doesn't really mean anything, right? So you kind of need a story structure. So you need a group of people to do kind of a little synopsis of the story. We call it treatment, how are you going to do it, okay? So that is the process. But this does not mean that the treatments, the structure that was formed during this period will be executed thoroughly. Because on the way developing this project, it might get changed. They might find some element that they thought is so interesting, better than what they thought originally. So they might change it totally. Okay. After that, then this is what, this is the stage I'm working on in the process. Oh, by the way, from here on to workbook, usually we call this pre-production. And from layout and color script, then we call it production. That's the part that people actually do it. And then from record, from outputs, and that's post. They call it post production. Okay. So what I'm working on is part of this pre-production, process. And of course, you got script, and then there's a storyboard here, and then we call it visual development. That includes character design and production design. And production design usually means the design for the settings and the mood. And then there's also sound, sound scratch. Here, people start try to find who would be a best choice for the characters, voice. And musicians start to write songs and even song effects and music, like Tarzan's special yell, that yell, someone got to create something about it. There's one concept I like to communicate with you guys. A lot of people thought the script was done and then we just bore it out. At Disney, that is totally false. When we were working on film, quite often as a storyboard artist, we never have a script. Quite often, it's just a couple, or sometimes we just get directions from the director saying that, we need a scene in which, maybe the lion jump over the cliff and realize something. A lot of people thought, the script was written and then we just bore it out and film got done. For TV animation, yeah, that is the case. For feature animation, this part, the reason I put it this way, or like parallel, is because these four parts, they constantly interact with each other. We get feedback from each other and the project evolve. And a lot of script is actually written down after the storyboard is done. Believe or not, that is the truth. But because writers, they belong to a writer's guild, a powerful writer's guild. And it's a very powerful kind of union type of organization, so usually they get all the credits, and the story artists, they don't, okay? But now the studio is talking about a better system. If you go back to the old Disney film, you never see a credit called writer. I don't know if you guys noticed that. At that time, there's only one credit, say story. And then under story, it's just names of storyboard artists and also story men. At that time, it's more like artists who tend to write better. They are more like writers. And also, of course, writers. They're under just one credit, just called story. Yeah. And the reason it's done recently this way is because a lot of new management that come to Disney, they are from the live action background. So they run animation the way, you know, live action does. And it just doesn't quite really justify, you know, the responsibility in the making of the film. But anyway, after that, then you got a story reel done, and I would assume you'll know what that is. Right? You do, right? What is a story reel? Okay. Right? You know, now there's a lot of like making of. You know, usually they show a reel that we sound with like storyboard cutting, or sometimes with completed scenes, and sometimes with just scratches of, you know, doodles, things like that. Just to give you a sense of, you know, the flow of the story. Yeah. And then workbook. Yeah. Workbook is it's a something looks like storyboard, but I know storyboard at Disney is different from the storyboard at television. Okay, for television animation, storyboard is done so tightly, you can pretty much, a lot of layout artists, you can pretty much blow it up, and yeah, then do your layout and kind of clean up, and that, yeah, that'll be it. At Disney, because everything interacts so much and everything changes so much, you never like bored like one sequence and hope and thought that they're going to put that into production. That rarely happened. Usually, like recently I bored something, you know, like, you know, for like, it took me like a month, and then it got just totally trashed because a character got changed. So things like what I'm doing wouldn't happen, so it would get trashed at Disney. So storyboards are very disposable. So for feature, we don't do, you know, those, you know, tiny little things. We just try to give a bigger stroke of what happened. And then if director decided, okay, this is good, and then they'll put it into the workbook stage, in which, yeah, the layout artist would take the storyboard artist and really make the staging looks nice, you know, maybe, you know, plan the shots better. And so that's the workbook stage. Yeah, for TV animation, storyboard and workbook is the same thing. But for feature animation, this is two different process. And then layout and color script, I think you guys know what layout is. Color script is just a bunch of, it's a visual script of like thumbnail sized, you know, pictures that you know, painters would do just to kind of rough out the color scheme of a whole sequence, you know, in time. Instead of one picture, it's a serious picture, because a movie we see, you know, shot by shot, you know, after one shot, and one color, you know, maybe red, and after that you have a blue one that has an emotional and visual impact to the viewer. And art, you know, art director will plan that out as well. They call that stage color script. And after that, we have, you know, character animation. Here you have, you know, key animation, and then cleanup animation in between. And then effect animation, you know. And then on the other hand, you have background, and then also computer element. And then all of this now is very much will be digitized. And then so you have to, you know, kind of scan them into computer and then do in-game paint, and then eventually you put character, effect, background, and computer, you know, element, you know, and you put together, that is compositing process, and then you output, and then now it's post, and recording, sound effect, score, and then editing, mixing, and then then you complete the film, and then there is a department who would archive all, you know, tons of boxes of these pictures. Yeah, they organize in a way so later when artists need to find reference, they know where, you know, they are. Remember, animation is it's just a tremendous, you know, work of, you know, labors get involved, and so there's tons of drawings, and you know, so we actually have a department, a lot of people working on just archiving them. So yeah, that's the system. So this system actually works for your personal film as well. It's just quite often a lot of steps was condensed. But I bet when you make a film, you're going to pretty much cover all of these processes, you know. But maybe not in such a defined manner, but, you know, but more or less. And then within this system, then you can decide, like me, I was a character designer, and you can, if you know that, and then you can decide, you know, if you, which part of the process that you think you enjoy doing, and then you would like to do it. You know, like usually animators are from, like, let's say Cal Arts, you know, because over there the training is all about animation, animating, and story, you know, storytelling. And then layout artists or background artists, usually they are from artists who has fine art training, you know, from Cal Arts or from like New York, some Pratt, or from illustration, you know, major, yeah, because they have a better sense of color and mood. So yeah, usually, you know, graduates from that school usually tend to, you know, work in a layout or background department. And yeah, people who are more into animating, yeah, tend to get into animation or storyboard, yeah. Or, and as to character designer, in a studio, there's no really such a category of job that you can apply to. It's, they just roughly call it visual development department. You know, there's no a specific job called character designer. You say, you can go there and hand you your portfolio, say, now I'm applying for a character designing job. Yeah, there's no such a thing. Usually characters, designer comes out within the system. You know, you were there as, let's say, an animator, or you were there as a visual development artist, and you tend to do better on the character side. You know, you have a special style, or you tend to have a better grasp of the characters. Then they'll put you in charge of a certain film, and so it's kind of a character design is kind of just happen during the process of visual development, that the director feel that, oh, this guy tend to, you know, do, you know, things that on the character side, and his style seems to be pretty interesting that we should try, you know, for. And yeah, that's how it happened. And so in the studio, let me see, probably just only three character designers as I can see. I mean, I can remember now. Yeah. So so when you're preparing your portfolio, make sure that it's for visual development in general. You know, not just character designs. And a lot of the stuff I'm going to show you today, yeah, a lot of them are character design. It's because I'm already in it and I'm categorized, and they think I'm specialized in character design. But actually, I do storyboard as well. But somehow, people just see me as a designer, and so that's how it goes. So, yeah. So, and then now let's talk about the graphic elements of character design. So, let's go to the next. Okay. Oh, I have to do this. Huh? Page down. Okay. Yeah, there's a couple, like, there's some elements. It's very simple. It's probably, you probably learn all of this through your art school. But I would like to kind of brush up a little bit, and hopefully you might think about it and differently. You know, there's some elements. There's, six elements? That's this graphic. There's the first one is shape, and the second one is volume. Third one, line. The fourth one, size, and then color and tone, and also texture. And then I'm going to talk about them, okay, one by one. Shape. Okay. Can we look at the picture? Yeah. See, the reason I pulled this picture out here is just to tell you how the shape, it's the most basic visual clue, you know, for human brain, you know, to recognize object, and how simple it can be and how primitive it is to human mind. You know, this in this rock painting, you know, it's basic just shapes there. But you can see, you know, there's horse riders, and you see a deer. But that means that those graphic up there, that has certain quality that make you associate with what you see in the reality. And shape is the most powerful, most simple and direct way, you know, for human brain to recognize object, and that is also how we as character designer, how we utilize that and think of it as the most important and element in designing a character. And so that's, let me go. And I would assume, you know, the teacher, you know, tell you about the importance of shape all the time. Here, this is an illustration of from the 40s, I believe, by Provenson, Martin Provenson. Look at this. There's humans there, and there's various animals in it, and each of them have their own distinguishable shape that make you recognize them, what they are. You know, like this, you know, like chicken, you have a chicken, a rooster, you know, they have certain shape, you know, like that. Look at them. There's very few interior lines. It's pretty much just the outline. But you look at that, you know right away what they are. And then geese and chicken here, and then turkey, there's goats, you know, there's cow here and horse. And I mean, this is a cow, this is more like an ox or bull. And then pigs, and then, you know, sheep. So I just want you to know the importance of shape. And next one, see? And then now this is all birds. This is also done by Provenson. See, different kind of birds. Okay, they are birds, but look at how different they are in terms of shapes. You know, you have a golden eagle, you know, vulture, and how do you call this bird? Oh, pelican. And then, you know, flamingos, thank you. And, you know, all these birds, they all have, you know, their own distinguishing, you know, shape. And as a character designer, you got to get this down, you know, right away. Otherwise, you might create something, you know, that you thought is one thing, but audience perceive it, you know, as another. And that happens, trust me. I don't know if I should give an example. You know, like Don Bluth's film, Penguin and the Pebbles. Is that the title? Penguins and the Pebbles, I think, yeah. They have a test screening, you know, they design a penguin in a way that after the show, you know, the kids will say, oh, we love the film, you know, wow, those bears look so cute. See, then you know you do something wrong. Because they didn't get the shape right. So you got all the production going on, you know, great animation, whatever, how great it is. If the shape doesn't recognize as what you design, you know, for, then you fail. Okay, and this shape-oriented approach actually, especially at Disney, was very much influenced and inspired by Mary Blair. She's a great, great illustrator from the 40s, I believe, 40s and 50s. And look at how simple he designed this lady. You know, everything is all shapes. And here's some children's book that I have. And look at the clarity. It's simple and it's clear, just like those rock paintings I show you. But of course, this is a little bit more sophisticated. And then for film, then you got even more sophisticated. But the basic idea is the same. Okay? And so, in shape, there's only three basic shapes when you think about it. This is Mulan. For Mulan, it's a gang of three. There's only three basic shapes, okay? Square, and a square, a circle, and a triangle. It's that simple. And then for this gang of three, we thought it's a perfect situation for us to do the character. And because these three characters are supposed to, you know, kind of hang around together, but you don't want to do three character looks, you know, alike. That would be very confusing to the audience, and their personality are so different, so you want to contrast them. So like, let's say this Chen Po, you know, he's our like big Buddha, so he's in the wrong shape. You know, everything, you know, the major element in designing this character is all, you know, circles. You know, he's wrong, he's powerful, but he's very, you know, he's a little bit shy, but he's and nice, and so everything. And then Yao, he's a bulldog, okay? He likes to fight, you know, without thinking too much. He's a rough. So everything about him is more like squarish. Even though the overall design element for Mulan is to make everything looks elegant. And then you have Ling, you know, everything is more triangular, as you can see. Okay, and later I'm going to also talk about color, how colors, you know, varies. And actually this three primary color, I mean not, here it's not primary, but it's actually, he is actually in red, and he's in blue, and he's in yellow. I know the color here doesn't really say that. But sometimes you don't want to contrast them too much. You know, in some story situation, you know, you want, you know, all the characters work as a group. You don't want them to contrast each other too much. You know, they work as a group. Then you would make them, you know, similar. When you design a character, you should have elements that will unify them, so to support the unity of this group. While you can do subtle variations, let's say on the face, you know, each one is different, but they all kind of looks alike in a certain way. So it really depends on what kind of story you're talking about. And the second one we're talking about volume. And volume, there's no such a thing called volume in animation. I mean, when I say that, I have to explain it. You know, everything is flat, okay? Volume is actually illusory, okay? It's an illusion. It looks like there's a three-dimensional stuff there, but actually, you know, doesn't matter, you know, yeah, I have to, just in case I forget. Nowadays, you know, they all call like traditional animation 2D, you know, because it's flat, and they call 3D animation 3D. So supposedly, you know, it looks more dimensional. But when you think about it, it is all on the screen, and the screen is flat, okay? Live action, do you call live action 3D? No, but it's still on the screen, right? It's flat. It's that illusion, that's what we're talking about. Yeah, and actually, when we say volume, it's actually a combination of shapes that make you think, that trick your brain to think it's dimensional. And I don't know if I should get into that. That hopefully teacher, you know, at the school will teach you, you know, some tricks about, you know, how to create the illusion. I guess I'll just mention a sum, so you can go home and think about it and see what you can do with just line. You know, like let me see. Like the first one would be, let me see. I'll just like overlapping. You know, if like two, like these two circles here. You know. You think that this is behind that, but it could be actually two shapes put together, right? So it's all 2D, but when I do that, you think it's three-dimensional. And also, let's say, and this is overlapping, and also size. You know, size difference. Then you tend to, because we tend to think this is the same size, and because of that, you think there must be a depth that makes this thing smaller, and I create an illusion of depth. So that's one way of doing that. And let me think. And what else? And also, or very similar fashion, a shape like, can you see? A shape like that, instead of reed, instead of being read as, how do you call this shape? You know, people tend to, oh yeah, thank you. Yeah. People tend to, especially when I draw a horizon line, people tend to think, you know, it goes into the distance. Yeah. So a lot of this thing that I would assume, you know, in the graphic design class that your teacher would go over and create that sense of depth and illusion. And this is just lines. So let's see, and then in 3D modeling, then you got sphere, cube, you know, like pyramid, this basic shapes, I mean, I should call them forms that you use to build your characters. So volume, and then let's talk about line. You guys all know line, but believe it or not, it took me, I don't know, only until when I was in my 20. When I was 26, I realized there's no such a thing called line in life. It's like I draw, like when you see my hand, did you see a line here? No, there's no such a thing called line. Line is more a concept than a visual element. And we see a line when it is contour of an object, then you see a line. Or when it's where, you know, color, two different color, you know, like black and white, when you put this two together, then you see a line. Or like two plane, when two plane intersect, then you see a line. So it's a concept. But line is very important, yeah, in doing character design in our medium. And then let's talk about quality of line. And there's two kinds. Line have two kind of overall, how should I put it, aspect, the shape and body. When I say shape, I mean line. There's only two kind of line here. Can we look at the picture? There's only straight lines and curves, straight and curves. This is a good example of a great artist, Mike Mignola, who specializes in you know, angular, you know, straight lines. And he just used this one element and makes such a, you know, powerful statement, you know, in his graphic work, and just amazing. And the second one is curve. Okay, this is Hirschfeld, you know, everything is curvy, you know. And straight lines tend to look, you know, more direct action, more action and power, and curvy lines tend to feel, you know, more, you know, graceful, elegant, you know, softer. Yeah, these are qualities. And these qualities, and when we do character design, we use, you know, these different kind of line qualities and try to, you know, create our characters, you know, but based on the shapes. And let me see, what is the next one? And then another, like, body of the line, you know, it's a, you know, thick and thin, and tapering quality in some. This is Craig Kelman's design for Samurai Jack, I believe. It's just a great design, you know. And you can see how he how masterful he is, you know, using those the thick and thin, you know, in the design. Okay, then let's talk about size. You know, again, there's only big, medium, and small. I know it sounds very stupid, but trust me, a lot of artists, when they're working on characters, they tend to forget it. You know, in developing characters, yeah, this is a size comparison for Mulan. You know, when you line the character up, and hopefully, you know, you shade them in with black ink, so you just see them as a blob. If your audience still can tell who's who, then you know you're pretty successful in terms of designing the shape for the characters. And of course, sometimes there's so many characters and the variation becomes pretty subtle. And so size would be another means that you can you know, consider to make your character looks, you know, very distinguishable. You know, like here, you know, there's the size difference. And it depends on the show too. If it's a more cartoony show, you can make the contrast of the sizes, you know, very drastic. If it's a, you know, a more realistic show, then yeah, it will be more subtle. So about size, and then let's talk about color. Okay, yeah, you guys all know about color theories. You know, color involves, you know, hue, volume, situation, and temperature. But unfortunately, in cartoon, we only do flat colors because of nature of the production system we were into. And and quite often, and character and background, usually characters, the color on the characters are flat, and the color on the background is all totally rendered with shade and everything. So they tend to look, they tend to have more depth. And so a lot of designers, they forgot that each character, when you put the character into environment, you know, all the color has to be, you know, refined. You know, like if you have a character, let's say he's in white and he's in a forest that you design, then assume the forest is in green, then the white cannot be white, otherwise the character will pop out. It feels like the character is floating, you know, on the background instead of in the background. So yeah, in this case, maybe you should just, you know, tune the color white into kind of cooler blue or greenish, you know, white. So their character was setting better, and setting. And the reason I use that picture is for the clarity. This is the older Mickey Mouse, and remember that. And in the old days, you know, his hands is all black, and at that time, artists started to discover that, you know, when you have, you know, since hand is the most, like, one of the most impressive elements of the body parts. That's why I tend to get lost inside the body. Just, let's say if Mickey Mouse has a hand, like within the silhouette of Mickey Mouse, you know, he's angry, then you probably won't be able to read it. So at that time, of course, the quickest way is to have the white outline, right? So later, you got a white glove, then it will be totally clear. So that's why sometimes you design something just to make things clear. But why a mouse wear gloves, who knows, right? And sometimes, yeah, and a lot of things you guys might think for granted, but like Bugs Bunny, like the belly of Bugs Bunny, remember? It got that white patch as the belly. Uh-huh. See, I thought that's a great, great design. This thing, if it's a close-up, let's say this is all blue. If you design this way, it would be so great, you know, for animators to do. So if you see something like that, you know this character is facing that way. If you see that, you know you are looking at his back. So yeah, that white patch is not just there for nothing. You know, there's a purpose for it. And that's how you use color for animation. And, you know, it's like magicians. A lot of magicians like to wear white gloves, you know, because they dim the light and they just want you to look at their hands. So while at the same time, they can do something that you won't be able to see. So yeah, that's the trick. And in animation, we use that to kind of direct the audience to look at a certain focus we want them to see. So when you're doing design, yeah, you have to constantly thinking about, you know, all these things. And hopefully you also use color. If you can, I mean, you don't have to do it all the time, but like in Mulan's case, we try to make it symbolic as well. Mulan is in pink, kind of purplish pink, not because, you know, girls wear pink. I mean, yeah, if you read it that way, that's fine. But we do that is for that sequence because she is the flower that her father is, you know, is talking about. She is the magnolia in the background. She's the flower, and so we want to, you know, to kind of, how do you call that? To kind of echo that idea. So she's the magnolia, you know. So that's why we you know, choose that color. Yeah, we don't choose it just because, you know, it looks feminine or that. But if you read that, that's fine. You know, it's for us. We're doing something. If the audience see it, great. If they don't, that's fine. As long as we know what we're doing. Yeah, originally I was going to show you clips of Run, but I forgot. That's my fault. In Run, I strongly recommend that you can go home and check that film out. It is an artist film, and you guys all know Kurosawa. Before he did the film, he painted, you know, many paintings, tried to visualize the film, and that film is so well designed. And now I just give you something that I pick up from the film. Okay, like the color in the film. You got the father, you kind of roughly know the story, okay. You got a father and three sons, and he kind of favored the two elder ones. But it turned out the third one, the little one, is actually the honest one. The one that he deserved, but later he realized he's a real, you know, royal son of his. The father is in gold. Okay, and then three sons, and then Kurosawa put his three sons in three different colors, three primary colors. The eldest son is in yellow, the imperial color. So through the story, you know he's going to be the emperor. The second son is in red. You know there's something about him which is related to violence. And the third one is in blue, obviously. That's a universal idea, you know, blue is a peaceful color. So through the story, the father, gold, becomes white. Okay, white, when you put these three colors together, that'll be white, right? Of course, he's a father, so he's in white. And the eldest son, yeah, becomes an emperor. But you know what? He got killed by his brother, of course, the second one in red. And who come to rescue? The blue one. And then when the father becomes mad, oh, that sequence, that is so beautiful. I can't believe I forgot to bring my DVDs to show you. I want to see it again. I have seen that movie for, I would say, at least 20 times. I just different time I pick up something, you know, he put it there. I mean,
power rangers are that way.
Oh yeah, thank you. Here we go. Uh-huh. Yeah, see, I mean, it works, right? Every time. And the father, when the father, yeah, he's in white. Okay, now he's got stripped off the gold. Now he's a commoner, and then he, you know, he can't believe that his son, betray him, and now he's crazy. He's white, and there's a shot of, you know, following shot of him, kind of mad. His hair is all messy, and he's just walking as white. And then Kurosawa probably has tons of fans, you know, of seeing, you know, blowing. You see the, you know, the dust coming up, and you see the clothes. It's flapping, and you know what's inside the clothes? What's the color? It's bloody red. And so you know what's inside his heart. Like he's totally dead now. It's all blood. It's all blood. And I was like, oh, that is so great. But as an audience, the first time you don't know, I mean, as an audience, you don't have to know that. I mean, you watch a film, it's like, oh my God. But as a designer, yeah, I tend to be more analytical. So I'm like, oh my God, that is just, it's like they designed it consciously and they hope they will affect you emotionally and without knowing it. Yeah, so. If you have good sense of color and good use of color, it's very, very powerful. Okay, the last one is texture. Texture and pattern. This is one thing that we don't quite do in traditional animation, simply because it's labor intensive and it's almost impossible to do traditionally by hand. You know, you do textures, and how are you going to do in between? You know, oh, it's very hard to track. So like Pink Panther, when they, that little guy, what's his name? When he was in a conductor, when they animated the hair, they just do a bunch of stuff and it would tend to flicker. For some film like that, it's fine, but for feature animation, it tend to be, you know, a bit distracted. So you try to avoid that. But now with computer, we can do it better. In the old days, when you have a close-up of, let's say, Snow White, the face becomes flat because we can only use one color. So they would airbrush, you know, some of the blushes, so it's hopefully to create some sense of, you know, volume, but it still kind of flickers. But nowadays, because of computer, we can do, you know, we can draw the shape, you know, those blushes, and then just kind of blur it. So it's getting better now. And pattern, yeah, we don't really do that very much, because, you know, it's just, imagine, you know, let's say if I have tattoos over my body, and you design a character full of tattoos, my God, how many years are you going to take to animate that thing? So usually we don't do that. But now with 3D computer animation, it's not a problem anymore. But that is the aspect that we in the old days, we don't, you know, venture too much into. So we know very little about it. And because of 3D animation, I think, you know, the aesthetics of animation will be, you know, refined a little bit. You know, the use of texture and pattern, I think, will be more integrated into the design, you know. And later I'll give, and actually I'm thinking about puppet tradition. You know, we haven't seen puppet show for a long time, you know, in our generation. Maybe our grandparents' generation, they might see puppet shows, but we don't watch that, I mean, very much. I mean, don't count the Sesame Street. I'm talking about, you know, as a story. No, actually, I was wrong, huh? Actually, they do feature films as well with puppet. Yeah, but anyway, it's very rare. And I started to feel maybe, you know, character design, maybe I should go back and find out more about, you know, the ancient idea of, you know, designing puppets. Because, yeah, those are, you know, caricature, you know, gray shapes and everything, and they also have textures. So that is one area I hope, you know, I haven't done that much yet, and maybe you guys can, you know, take over the baton and, you know, do something about it. And for some, like, independent filmmakers like Frederick Buck, you know, this is how he draw, and they move on screen beautifully, you know, fully utilize, you know, those, you know, little, yeah, yeah. And then this one, yeah, it's also from Man Who Planted the Trees, you know. Yeah, And that quality, he used a multi-layer cross-dissolve. I don't think they call it cross-dissolve. It's not cross-dissolve. Cross-dissolve is two pictures, right? He used like, it's actually more like, how should I, three or four pictures all in the same time. Oh, I think they call it weaving, I think. Yeah, weaving. And you can see the color and the shade kind of shimmering, and it's very impressionistic and just has a grace, beauty of, you know, painting, and which, you know, we just cannot do, you know, in a commercial world. And so, and this is from his film Crack, a beautiful film. Okay. So now, let's move on to talk about the art of line. Okay. We just talk about the elements, but we use most of the time we use line, you know, to do that. And here's I would like to like cover, just kind of brush up a little bit about, you know, some principles on, you know, a good character drawings before we get on, you know, some aspect of like design. And, you know, like, first, I would like to say it's simplification. You know, it's simply, you know, film goes, you know, goes by so fast. You know, it's not like photography that you can go there and, you know, and look at it forever. Film goes by, and there's tremendous amount of work that get involved in animating. So we like, you know, simple characters. There's less mileage, and without sacrificing the expression, and so simplification used, yeah, is always the number one, you know, criterion for good, you know, character design. And the second one, and hopefully in your design, there's a sense of gesture. And here you can see, this is a page from Preston,
Blair.
Yeah, Preston Blair. Yeah, he's a great draftsman himself. Here he remember that, can you see? Yeah, you can see. Yeah, that red line, yeah, that's the action line. That give you a very strong sense of direction of the gesture, you know, and pose and move. You know, in character design, you don't just design a character, you know, standing there. You try to, give the audience a sense of, you know, who he is and attitude. So, you know, a representative pose would be great. And curves. And let me see. And let's talk about, I guess I have to draw like reverse curves and opposing arcs. This is a graphic element that tend to work better for feature animation. I think they call this reverse S-curve. It looks like S-curve, but it's more like just just arcs too. You know, if you have, let's say a guy, I don't do that, okay? That tend to look mechanical. But if I do that, then that tend to look more natural. So this is the reverse S-curve or opposing arc. When we're talking about opposing arc, you know, when you draw an arm, okay, this is just some principles. But that doesn't mean that it cannot be, you know, broken. The rules are there. It meant to be broken, okay? Remember that picture I just showed you that Craig Kelman did, of that big, you know, Highlander? He did arms with like straight, opposing curves. You know, he just wanted to show the bulkiness of the guy, so the arm is like that, okay? Because he's involved in a more cartoony show, he does that. Usually for a more realistic approach, you try to use, they call it straight against curve, okay? If you have one side is curved, the other side either is straight or it's a less curve. Does that make sense? That tends to look more organic. The reason for that is just simply it's how nature works. Let me show you a little bit about anatomy, okay? Like your arm, this is a muscle, okay? Muscle never was put together like side by side like that, because it simply takes space and you waste space, okay? God is a smart creator. He doesn't do that. He always put put muscle this way, save space, and make every space, you know, in good use. So, and because of doing this, you always get this kind of curve instead of this. And it tends to look mechanical and looks dead. And things like that tend to look more lively. It's just simply how nature works. And it takes...
Show them some electrons where you have to put them.
Oh. Okay, but that's then. Let me move on, and then later when we have time, then I'll show you that. Okay, and let me see what else. Yeah, straight and against curve I talk about, and squash and stretch. Unless the guy is a soldier who stays still. Speaking of straight against curve, there must be a lot of Batman fan here. Did you see the design of the, you know, Batman? It's all about straight against curve. You know, if you have a leg like that, this is how he draw the leg, straight and then curve. It's that simple, basic idea. He just tear all the subtleties apart and just show you, you know, the essence of a graphic design right there. And wait, what am I going to talk about? Oh, squash and stretch. Yeah, unless it's a soldier standing still. Otherwise, there's always, you know, two opposing force, you know, at work. And so, let's say, and Greek had discovered this, you know, 1,000 years ago. And I can't believe that we as artists we're still struggling with it today. You know, our body has a certain rhythm, you know, this is a human, okay. Our body, yeah, as I said, unless it's a soldier, otherwise we tend to, you know, shift our weight, you know, into one leg of the other. We never distribute our weight, you know, equally on the foot. And that is also one of the rules that will create a good character drawing. So, and that creates squash and stretch. When I mean that, you know, like this torso here, because it's linked to the other way. So here it's got stretched, and on this other side, this got stretched, and this is squashed. And a good drawing usually has these two, you know, forces, you know, working, you know, side by side. So that is one. And volume, as I said, you know, it's illusory. And how do you show volume? I just give you ideas. And like if you have an arm, let's say it looks like a cylinder. See, usually we draw it like that. You don't draw it this. Okay, this is from the straight profile. So you just see the big shape. And so it looks flat. But if you draw it this way, it tends to look, you know, has a volume. And anything works that way. Like when Disney do a good profile drawing, you know, like when you're a drawing character, let's say, okay, I'm going to do a bad drawing here. Let's say this character. And with eyes. When Disney do the eyebrow, you know, I don't know if you notice, we always put a little bit of thing here and a little bit thing here. That tend to suggest, you know, the other side, this plane here. And that makes this profile look dimensional instead of a straight cutout. Okay, these are tricks, but I just thought that it's good for you to know. And solid drawings, and you need to convey a sense of weight, you know, again, this drawing, you know, or let's say, if you draw things, if this is a bubble, you know, you like, it might sag a little bit because of the weight. When you draw a feet, you know, you draw something that you feel, you know, that because of the weight, it kind of, how do you say, sag a little bit. Yeah, so that sense of weight is very important as well. And then talk about rhythm. Oh, this took me a lot of time to realize as well. Yeah, rhythm is a musical term. Yeah, what is rhythm in a drawing? What does that mean? It takes me a long time to understand. I can draw your leg, okay? This is ground. It takes me a lot of time to realize what is rhythm. Rhythm also, it's a, how should I phrase it? It's like a varied repetition called rhythm. It's just like music, okay? It's like, if it's a waltz, it got an accent, right? It's boom, cha, cha, boom, cha, cha, or it's boom, cha, 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 boom, cha, cha, cha. This, we can find that on the drawing as well. Now, let me see if I can, let's say if I'm drawing a leg, this is the outer contour of the leg, okay? That is a big rhythm. This is the big accent we're going to hit. And then inside it, we have smaller accent. Did you see that? And then I have a leg, and that's the rhythm. This is boom, cha-cha, boom, cha-cha. That is the rhythm. And in drawings, when you design a character, try to apply that into your design. You might, you know, on one side of a character, there's a big sweep of a line. It's so powerful. On the side of the shape, then you have something more subtle. And so they play along like walls, you know, like a beautiful lady and a handsome guy, you know, dancing together. Yeah, this is the idea. And perspective and depth, again, this is just a little trick. You know, a lot of people tend to design a character, let's say, they design a character and stand still and they're on like that. A better one would be to show a sense of depth by maybe position the feet in slightly different fashion. You know, this suggests a plane, and that tend to look the character more dimensional. And this is flatter. I'm not saying this is better than that. I'm just saying this will give you a sense of depth. And then depends on the show, you decide what you want to do. But you should know this. And, dynamic and tension. That also make good drawings. And that usually means twist. Okay, I'm not going to draw that. As, again, a soldier, you know, this is symmetrical, this is boring. But when you do something slightly, has the weight shifted, a twist, something, that tend to make a character look more lively and looks alive. Like eye, when you draw like eye, you never draw like eye like that. That tend to look, a character looks not, this tend to look that the character is thinking. I'm not saying all the time, okay? I'm just saying think about this. Because some of the shows, they love this. And I like that too. Because I like that kind of weird quality about the design. But this tend to look like, oh, the character is actually has a brain. He's thinking about something. And this is, yeah, maybe I draw the eye bigger. So it doesn't look like he's surprised or something. Yeah, it tends to look like, no, he's just there. He's kind of, you know, how does that, you know, the mind is kind of absent a little bit. Okay, and, tangent. That happened all the time. Oh, actually, this morning I saw student work. Yeah, that almost feels a tangent to me. Tangent, the tangency, you guys know the idea, right? It's, okay, the best way to illustrate this is, this is an example from a book I read. I thought it was really good. So I'll do it again. Okay. When you draw a boat and a cliff and the ocean, actually do it here. Disregard this one. If you put this boat right here and you have a cliff here, that's a tangency. The tangency is very confusing because people don't know if this shape is belong to this boat or it's a different, you know, entity. So in character, you don't do, let me see. Let's say if you do a character like that, okay, let's say this is your character. Here it would be the tangent because it's cut. The outline of the hand cut with the outline of the body. And I'm not saying you cannot do that. If you know what you're doing, you can always break the rule. But I'm just saying, you know, you should try to avoid some tangency because it's very confusing to the audience. They don't know what it is. Let me see if I can get, yeah, this morning there's an example, it's more like, let me see if I can draw that one again. I think it's more like that. Oh, wait. think it's something like that. Yeah, things like that, yeah. You know, this line, is it belong to this lower arm or is it belong to the upper arm? It's very, I mean, yeah, it's kind of confusing. I mean, it's okay. It's not too bad. But if you can make it clear, why not? So either move it out, becomes more like that, or move it in to the body. So, and it shouldn't be that hard to do that, you know, change. And let me see what else. And anatomy. Yeah, and we are doing cartoon, but quite often we were asked to do realistic characters. So, oh, this is a note from Disney, you know, we all learn from, oh. What I know today, even though some of the notes are like what I learned myself, but majority of them I learned from my teachers in the school and from my colleagues at work. You know, I really learned a lot from it. And this is one of the hangouts that Disney give to the artists. You know, just a simple Tigger drawing, but you know, there's all the aspects I just mentioned. You know, construction. You know, straight against curve, and weight, and you know, volume, shape. Everything is there. And you design a character, not just, you know, a character stand there still. It has to be in good shape, but when the character in action, they have, you know, each drawing has to have a good shape as well. And also anatomy, you know, sometimes, you know, we have to do character like that. So you better, you know, get yourself familiar with anatomy so you feel at ease when you are doing an assignment like that. And okay, now let's move on to design. Okay. Design, the first thing about design, for those guys who are writing notes, write down story, please. Yeah. Please, please, please. It's all about story. It's all about story. Yeah, you don't design something, I mean, of course you can. You can design something just for fun, for yourself. But the design, every character design has to work within the story. You know, when the story changed, the design changed. Because I believe each story is unique if it's a good one, and the character in it has to be unique. Only work in that story. And here I'm going to show some early design of Mulan. See, this is Mulan, and let me see. This is another one, and here's another one. And when it gets closer to production, it gets tighter. And styling was put there and get closer to the final look. Okay, so that's the early design. And yeah, at Disney, character storytelling is actually more about, I should say, yeah, storytelling. Instead of a story itself, it's storytelling. It's quite, there's a big difference here for me. Hopefully, you know, I'll tell you, see if you guys agree. You know, a story, you know, like, what make a story great is the storytelling, not the story itself. You know, I remember Don Bruce was doing. Maybe I should mention him again because I feel so bad. But anyway, yeah. You know, there's many people who tell stories. It could be the same story we heard over and over again. You know, let's say Snow White. You know, I can tell a bad Snow White story to you, but some other people who's so good at, you know, at the narrative, and he know how to use the words, and as graphic artist, you know how to use, you know, the graphic elements, so you can tell a better story. So it's the telling that really make a difference. And at Disney, the telling is all about characterization. You know, I can give you an example that is totally opposite from Disney, then you probably would know what I'm talking about better, like Miyazaki's film. It's a great film, but it's more about story itself. It's plot. When I say plot, and Disney is more, but this is my personal opinion, you don't have to agree. Disney is more about character. You know, a lot of Disney stories are so simple. There's no subtle, like, messages or, you know, like, humanity, you know, the depth of humanity in it. Really, not really. It's all about entertainment. And it's all about character. And it's all about making movie stars. It's a general idea in Hollywood. You know, why movie star? Because that's a merchandise. A Miyazaki character, they tend to look alike, you know, I'll show you later, but it's all about the story. You know, the characters serve the plot. It's a plot-oriented story, and this is more like character-oriented story. This story is so simple. It's always a good guys and a bad guys, and then good guy kick the ass of the bad guy, and then that's the story. Yeah, right. When you think about it, pretty much all about that. Very simple, but it's the characters that they develop that is so interesting that the audience that gets so mesmerized by it, and they are not drawings anymore. They are like blood, you know, flesh and blood characters become movie star. And this trend is, yeah, we learn from Hollywood, because a movie star off screen, they still a movie star, and you know, they still make money. And for Disney, once you create this icon, then it's merchant. How do you go? It's you can make it into merchandise, and you can how do you say it?
License?
No, merchandisable.
Marketable.
Yes. Here. Yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's based on this idea. So each character we create is a movie star. It has its unique personality that is so unique that people, it's so memorable. People remember them. So later the studio can sell them. You know that, but I'm not saying that you have to do that, okay? That's your choice. But Miyazaki's is that is about story. And ours is more about characterization. Nothing wrong with either one of them. It's just the preference. And when you do design, you have to think about, all about this. I mean, or at least you should know. And at Disney, story is always changing. Character design is always changing, so the character evolved. I show you some early design of Mulan, because she used to be like a tomboyish girl, and she like adventures, things like that. You know, in some early version, so she's in, you know, like looser pants, so she can do all that. And later, you know, she's more like just a regular, you know, demure, you know, girl, you know, who just, you know, just like a girl, you know, that you see all, you know, every day, next door. And so, yeah, that when story changed, you know, the character's costume and even facial, you know, characteristic would change accordingly. So, and then let me see. And of course, personality. This is some design I did for Tarzan. Actually, this is all on different sheet of paper, but for the presentation, I kind of cut them out and put it all together. Yeah. And just tons of design done at Disney for one character. And this is just a few of them, so you can see. You know, this is for Chen in Tarzan. You know, they're all different, hopefully. And and hopefully they all project different personalities. And okay, then let's talk about, this is Tarzan. This is early Tarzan. It's more graphic. Again, right, that's a bad man approach. When I get on it, I'll just, because I was on bad man, so I already know how to do it, and I just naturally draw that, even though, you know, I don't really like it, but.
Like
Batman is Tarzan. Yes. and then I did tons of drawings. And then eventually, this is the one they like, and so this is what it did. And then after that, the animator in Glenkin did his pass on it and really did a lot of great gestures to him. You know, this is the face that the director thought is, you know, pretty close to what they kind of pictured. So they picked that, and then Glenn just took over and did, you know, amazing stuff to it. You know, instead of, like, right now, he's kind of boring, just standing there. Glenn kind of make him, like, you know, kind of crunch, more like an ape. And that is really a big breakthrough in terms of designing the character. And I wish I can claim that, but I, you know, he did. And, and personality. And, you know, like, this is a design for, you know, in that baboon chase, this is one of the designs I did for them. Yeah. But they thought it was a bit too scary for kids. But I was like, but isn't that supposed to be scary? And so that's one design, and that's another one. And then it could be, ferocious, or it could be cute like this one. It's a character that got cut out. Tentor, you know, the elephant, you know, used to wrestle with this little guy called it's a kind of animal called Hyrax. It's a close relative of elephant, believe it or not. Yeah. Yeah, check the, you know, the what, the animal planet, then you get to know that. Yeah, but later they decided to cut that scene, so this character was out. Yeah, so here you see, actually this is, you see three designs here. Yeah. And yeah, and personalities and hopefully relationships too. This is one of the early, you know, inspirational sketches for Mulan. And not only I try to get a shape of these two different characters, and I also try to get the relationship of this character and hopefully a situation.
Those trees that you drew back there are yeah. the same kind of outside of the plaza right here. And I always think of your drawing, this drawing,
yeah.
when I see those trees.
Oh, really? Okay.
It's a. So
oh, thank you. Yeah, and I was so intimidated, so I didn't color it, because I know I would ruin it. I was horrible at color, I have to say. So I'm a bit more conservative. And yeah, and then let's talk about, let's see, here I guess I have to draw, and some archetypes. I'm going to talk about archetypes in character design and stereotypes in character design. Archetypes apply to all, you know, genders or races, you know, things which reflect a variation of humanity. I mean, varieties of humanities. We call that archetypes. Okay, I'll just do some like simple ones. Okay, like Batman. Okay, that's one archetype. Okay, you got a person kind of, you know, Superman, and oh, maybe you have a. Let's say, bad girl, you know, kind of nice, sexy, you know, kind of like this kind of character. And you have, let's say, what is the name of that guy, that monster? And tend to be Clayface, okay. Or you have, let's say, a droopy guy, kind of dumb guy, you know. It's more like that. Okay? Oh. Yeah, you see. Yeah, you see, can you see, yeah, you see all of that, right? Yeah, we call this archetypes. It reflects, you know, an aspect of the humanities. So this is archetype. So you can apply it to, you know, any film you like. And then there's another one. What? Oh, what is that? Amazing.
Choco Monkey 7. In Rancho Cucamonga wants to know what anime characters you just showed there.
What? Which one?
The one you have.
Here?
No, on the television.
On the television? Oh, actually, I don't know. Sorry. It's an anime. Yeah. I mean, it's a Japanese animation, yeah. But I don't know what it is. Okay, this is stereotype. Yeah. This is, okay, when you use a graphic, you know, just one single type of graphic, you know, element to overgeneralize, let's say, a race in this case, then that's stereotype, okay? And actually, stereotype has a certain degree of truth to it. I've seen Chinese look just like that. Yeah, and, but that doesn't mean every Chinese looks like that, right? So, but, in the old days, for some reason, every time they draw a Chinese, that's how it looks like. Okay, so that's a stereotype. And back then, every time when they draw a black, it always looks like that. I don't know why, but anyway, yeah, this is stereotype. It's just totally neglect the subtle variations of humanity. And I think as a good character designer, you should try to avoid that. And later, I'm going to show you examples how. And also practice how you can avoid that. And first, of course, you know, respect your subject. Doesn't matter what you're doing. It could be a mice. Respect that. And really do research about what a mice is about. So you do something different. Otherwise, you end up drawing Mickey Mouse or Mickey Mouse alike over and over again. And you are not a good character designer doing that. Again, if you draw Chinese like that once, that's okay. If you keep doing that, then you are a bad designer. And same thing to this guy. So, okay, this is a stereotype. Let me, okay, and yeah, later I'll show you more. And let's talk about formula. Formula and industrial style. That's why I put that picture up. You know, like Japanese anime. Doesn't matter what kind of race they portray. They draw the character pretty much the same way. It could be in black color or in white color. And you know, that's the way they do it, and they really have great dressmanship. You know, I have no complaint about it, but I'm just saying my personal preference, I would like to see variations. In anime, it doesn't matter if it's of, you know, African or European or Chinese, you know, they're going to draw them pretty much identical. Maybe the color tone will be different, but yeah, that's how they're going to treat it. And that's the industrial style. It's their idea of beauty, and nothing wrong with that. If you like that and really, really, really like that, you can do that too. But personally, as a character designer, I thought it's not.
It's limited.
Yeah. Visually, it's not very interesting. You know, it's the same thing over and over again. And so, at Disney, we tend to draw characters a certain way too. It's very dangerous, you know, because it looks so likable. You like them, so you like to draw that way. But at the same time, you know, it's like, but you've seen that so many times. Why do you do that again, over and over again? It's so boring. So this is in. So and then let's talk about. Let's see. Appeal. This is Tetsuka Osamu, a big Japanese, you know, cartoonist who has a great influence on the Japanese, you know, anime and cartoon industry overall. Yeah, he's the guy who is strongly influenced by the German QB dolls. I think in the turn of the century. In the turn of the century, the QB dolls sold so well, everybody liked it. And everybody started to draw that. And in Japan, he picked up that cue and then started to use it, you know, extensively in his work and create a style of his own. Yeah. And yeah, Osamu Tezuka, that's, you know, this character. Appeal, it's very subjective and it's a matter of taste. But usually, for some reason, we tend to like baby-like characteristic. You know, bigger eyes tend to look more appealing to us. And you know, kind of fuller, you know, how do you call this? Cheeks, yeah, tend to look, you know, more appealing to us. And yeah, and this guy totally know how to use that as a way to get readers into the story right away.
But look at his face too, as you can see in the picture there.
Mm-hmm.
His characters look like him.
Oh, see if I can. He always liked to do a caricature of himself. And how does he draw his eyes?
Right.
Yeah, he has that. How does he? I don't know. But anyway, something like that. Yeah, that's yeah. Osamu Tezuka, and looks, you know, kind of like, yeah. Yeah, he. And that not only, see, you can apply, you know, those cues onto not only a young boy, or it could be to a, you know, a fully grown, you know, adult, you know, woman. And somehow it works pretty well so far, you know, especially Japanese like it. And, you know, like this is from the master filmmaker Miyazaki. See, look at this. It's very appealing, but at the same time, to me personally, I wish that he would do something different. This is from three different films. From Kiki's Special Delivery, and from Nausicaa, the Wind Valley, and from Lupin the Third. They are great films, and I really admire his sense of storytelling. But in terms of character design, they seem to me too much alike. And but some Japanese animators, they have a different point of view. They say, oh, it's just like, you know, there's, you know, Julia Roberts, you know, he could be in The Beautiful Woman, but she also could be in, what's his name? Alan Brokovich? Yeah. So to them, if the character looks the same, to them it's okay. Okay, and that's fine for a filmmaker, but I'm a character designer. To me, that'll be a lame excuse for not doing it. Okay, and now let's talk about caricature. And.
Ha 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 ha
I say what I meant.
John.
And let's talk about caricature and exaggeration. Remember, I say, you know, we should try to avoid, you know, stereotyping. And here I want to show you some African art. I thought it's a great, great, you know, exaggeration and a great, a very playful design of, you know, elements. And that still looks like, that still kind of represent that race very well. Look at this one. And this is, look at all, you know, different shapes, you know, how they explore different shapes. You know, this is all, you know, they all looks like Africans. Look at this one. Oh, this is one of my favorite. But they're all different. They don't look like what I just showed you. Mm-hmm. Right? Okay, and this is them. And I thought this is great. And to me, this is our cartoon. And actually, this could be like models for
inspiration.
Yeah, really great. So, and this is Hirschfeld. And look at this, right? So it has a sense of reality to it. And I appreciate this more. That's another, yeah. And this is my work on Tarzan, some secondary characters, just some henchmen that, yeah. But yeah, they, when the animator took over, they kind of, yeah, changed it. So I have to admit, you know, I don't like what they do with my characters. But anyway, here, oh yeah, he's amazing. But this is a bunch of secondary characters, so I try to unify them at the same time, look them different. So my meaning of using it is, you know, they all wear white. See, at that time, the director has this great idea, and I can't believe I'm the only one who follow it through, because eventually, even the director changed their idea, and I'm still doing the old idea they, you know, they tell me. They told me the ape are kind of in darker color, so they represent, you know, the good. And the invaders, you know, those colonists, you know, they are more like in a lighter tone, you know, lighter color, so, you know, they are kind of whiter. Okay, I say, okay, that's a great idea. You know, this is, I'm not saying that you have to say that to the audience, but just visually, that's how you play it. And then eventually, I'm the only one, you know, to the end of the production, I'm the only one who is still thinking that way. And everybody, they all changed. And I still think that is a good idea, but somehow it wasn't like carried through, and I thought that was quite a shame. And anyway, here I used the, you know, the white to kind of unify them, so hopefully they will work as a group. But then, you know, they all kind of, they all big guys, and but they all, you know, hopefully they all this, you know, distinguishable, you know, individually. And again, a lot of this, it's a caricature that I did some caricatures to start with, and then I started to simplify in a way that, you know, it will be easier for animators to handle. So actually, all of this are caricatures from some, you know, bikers. You know, I have a picture, so a portrait of bikers, and then I thought, okay, interesting. So I just do a bunch of them. And the one on the far right, that is one of my director.
Yeah.
Okay, see, that is ultimate caricature. You know, when I see this design, I thought, oh my God, that is so great. Even though, you know, I just cannot take it. It's just too much for me. But in terms of design, I thought it's very refreshing. It has that caricature quality that is so great. You know, it looks like someone I have seen before, or maybe, you know, next to me. not this moment, but I mean, you know, a studio. Yeah. When you do good research and really observe, you know, real people, you can always find, you know, graphic element that you can use in your design and make it different. And so that's one. And here, Simpson. This, then I guess I'm going to talk about, yeah, the grotesque caricature versus the beautiful ideal. Yeah, caricature tend to look grotesque and, yeah, how many years ago was this? 5 years ago, I was in Taiwan. I was at Cuckoo's Nest, you know, the biggest, it was once, you know, the biggest studio, you know, of the world. And they were doing a lot of TV stuff for, you know, American market. and they were doing Simpsons over there. And I looked at that, I was like, oh my God, that is so ugly. I mean, but I heard that it was the most popular show in America. So I thought, oh my God, American has bad taste. How can they like things like that? And then I came to America, and then I watched it. I say, wow, it's popular. Why? Why is that? Why? Mm-hmm. And I watched, after four or five shows, I thought, wow, they were so adorable. They were so cute. Oh, I love them. And that's what I mean, story, character. It's actually even more important than the design itself. And character tends to look grotesque, so you have to kind of work around. I'm not saying you do a caricature and then you just say, okay, that's the design. Yeah, it tends to look kind of scary. So you have to kind of bring it back a little bit. So it's a constant balance of this ideal and the interesting grotesque quality that you find in caricature, and this ideal, that's beautiful ideal that people can quickly like the character. See, this took me like 5 episodes to like them. But when I look at Disney character, they're so appealing, you just get into the story right away. So that's the difference. And let's talk about costume now and props. Okay, this is a quote from my colleague. Okay, Jeff Ranjo, he says, it's not what you wear, but how you wear it. I thought it was great. And so, yeah, think about that. And I don't think I need to articulate it too much. But anyway, this is one of the early costume design for Mulan. At that time, we have no idea of who she is, and we just play around. And so this is just one of the ideas. And research and development. You're a character in a studio situation, you never do a design and show it to the director, and director will say, yes, that's it. And that it never worked that way, okay? The director always say, it's good, can you change the nose a little bit? And then next time you do that and you come back, it's like, can you change, make the arm slightly, skinnier. And so it just keeps changing. And because, in the director's mind, the story, is constantly changing. And so in his mind, the character is constantly shifting. So prepare yourself for that. So don't get frustrated. See that as a challenge. So do a lot of research, like costume. See, like for Mulan, this is just a few of the costume, work that we researched. Okay, anyway, there's some like Tang Dynasty, sculptures that has very precious, costume reference for our film, and some the real stuff. But look at those armor, it's just tiny place over the place. I mean, then I have to learn how to simplify it, and I have difficulty to simplify this type of armor. I think they call it lamella armor. It's made with many many tiny plates and string together. So. And then we found this ancient mural, and we see, this is how ancient artists see it. And I thought, wow, that's a really good way of doing it. So, research should help me, understand things. And also, because I never seen those real armors personally, I never. And so I don't know what is important, what I can leave out and what I should keep. But by seeing that, I know, I know how they see it. So when we do Mulan, this is how we do it. And this is the model sheet. And do research. A lot of person, they say, oh, but I got imagination, I can imagine it. I say, yeah, right. Yeah. And you are just lazy to do, it's just an excuse not to do the hard work. Just research your subject and really respect it, and really want to know it. Like at Disney, we really do our best, to know our subject. When we were doing on the Western, they send us to Wyoming to be cowboys for like a week. We ride on a horse and get to know what the cowboys is about, is like, and things like that. And like when we work on Emperor's New Groove, they send people to Peru to go there and kind of get a sense of atmosphere and the color. Yeah, so research. And
did they send you the Bob's Big Boy too?
Yeah, of course. Thank you. And then, if they're going to follow, you know, their research truthfully, then that's a decision. You know, quite often Disney, you know, do all the research and later they just totally forget about it. That happens too. And then let's talk about style. Okay, again, style is a matter of taste. And I just like you to look, you know, kind of think about it. But I would say, at this moment of your life, don't think about it too much. Just make sure that you do good designs, good drawings. Style will come naturally, because everybody has this strange personal preference. You know, like, you know, some people, you know, he just fall in love with Batman, and then he will get more influenced by it, and then he will tend to draw more like that. And some people like, let's say, anime, and then they would tend like to draw, you know, those big eyes, you know, and those, you know, the spiky hair. You know, that's fine. But anyway, this is some of my early designs, and you can see how I changed as well. So this is one style I had, and how many years ago? 14 years ago. This is a project for Cuckoo's Nest. So at that time it's more cartoony, kind of UPA-like, and kind of weird. And then this is, you know, for Batman. You can see how simplified it is. It looks simple, but it's not easy to draw though, to draw well. You know, a lot of overseas animators, they just cannot handle it well. Yeah. And even though it looks so simple. And this is a great example of design. It looks so simple, but there's actually a lot of knowledge in it. And because it is simple, so it's there's less labor for animator. If you are a good animator, you know, it's just less labor. You can do more with less. And then in a studio system, you know, as a designer and as a artistic supervisor, you know, there's a bunch of animators that you have to tell them what you try to achieve. And so you have to do a style guide. You know, this is a style guide. I know it's very technical, it's very boring. I'm not gonna go through it. But anyway, there's a style guide. Try to, you know, it's just a bunch of like hangouts telling the animators how to draw my characters, you know, what make my character looks different from others. Okay? And so there's some, like for Mulan, for instance, you know, the S curve is a big, you know, element in the show. We try to make every character looks very elegant, very graceful. Doesn't matter if it's man or guy, and there's some, you know, some ideas in it, and here just try to illustrate it. And then there's also a maquette that was sculpted. And so for animators, for reference, you guys all know that. And the reason I show this slide is after you design characters, quite often things won't work the way you expected. It might not animate well, you know, like dinosaurs. At that time, the original idea for dinosaur is they're going to have a voiceover. You know, the dinosaur just move like real dinosaurs, and then they're going to have voiceover who say, you know, the dinosaur will never do this. Okay, and the dinosaur just, and when they were talking, there will be voice say, hey, how are you today? Very good. Or, you know, originally they're going to do it that way, but later they thought it's very difficult for that to carry a sincere and feature film. So they decided, okay, the dinosaur had to talk. But remember, dinosaur, think of crocodile, okay, their mouth is like wide. It's like, how should I explain this? You know, that this opening, yeah, is going to very back. Imagine a dinosaur do a ooh sound. How are you gonna do that? It looks really strange. So that means it's time to cheat. So instead of doing a dinosaur looking head, they come out a head that is a compromise. That is more like a horse head. And hopefully you do it in a way audience will never question it. And also the position of the eyes. Okay, a lot of dinosaurs, the eyes are further apart on the side. And how can you do an expression like that? And you just cannot. It's just right here. So they have to move the eye, you know, a little bit forward. even though they still try to make a realistic film, but they still have to they have to make it believable, but at the same time, they can do expressions. So cheat, yeah. All the rules I told you so far, you try to work it out. If you cannot, then just do whatever works. Just totally forget about all that stuff. So, and then for the model sheet, yeah, it's about consistency. And let me see. I guess that's design. Oh, how about computer animation? Oh my God! See, I don't do computer animation very much, even though I get involved quite comprehensively. But it seems to me, yeah, the climax of the industry is changing, and it seems to me I have to go home and kind of reorganize my thought about character design because of this new art form. I never really thought about how my theory would apply to computer animation. I mean, I'm a character design for computer animation. But I do notice that in recent years, we see a lot of, designs for computer animation, especially those games tend to look just overwhelming. It's like unnecessarily overwhelming. Just tons of stuff because computer can do all the work for you. And then artists suddenly just forget that, the good aesthetics. They just overload with, computer with stuff. Now they don't have to labor on. And yeah, character tends to look just tons of destructive stuff and everything. But yeah, as I mentioned, I think I have to do some homework and study the puppet art, and hopefully, that'll help me. And I would like you, I mentioned it, and would like you guys, to think about it too, because that's quite different medium now, because it's not really animation as we understand it. And it's because if this is done so realistically, like let's say the Final Fantasy, better than Final Fantasy, let's say one day computer can do a film that looks just like it was shot, on the set, would you still call that animation? That'll be a question mark. And maybe in the future, animator don't have to, let's say, keyframe the movement anymore. A lot of things can be, can be programmed, because it could be, a lot of motions can be simulated. And that still leaves space for animator and for, let's say, acting. But then I'm started wondering, let's say one day if the computer can take over acting as well, let's say the program is so sophisticated, so huge, and it can simulate human behavior and human thought, then do we still call it animation? And so let's get crazy now. Yeah, it's just, yeah, you can put that in thought, and I just thought, this is interesting. But as I mentioned, at least, the way we understand it now, as I said, doesn't matter if it's on television or it's on movie screen, it's still a two-dimensional medium. And to understand 2D animation, I guarantee you, it's going to help a lot, because you still need to stage the character in a two-dimensional way. Like magician will never do magic in front of his body because it's all black and you're not going to see it. They always do that. A lot of like older actors in the older days, they know how to pose themselves toward the camera because they know that they look better that way, and they think about that. And I think we should think about that too. A lot of good 3D animators, they are actually very good, traditional animators as well. I mean, at this moment, they know how to stage it, so audience can see things clearly and directly.
And lighting.
Yeah, lighting the same.
They put lighting.
Yeah, and it's just a great, new medium, yeah. But it does cause a painful transition at this moment to the industry. A lot of traditional, artists are out of work because of this transition. So you guys should prepare for this new wave of something big. I see it very positively. It's like the phoenix. When it burns itself and becomes so bright and so incredible, then he has to die. and turn himself into ashes so he can be, you know, reborn. And it seems to me the animation industry is going through that stage now. And I think it's going to be great, and you guys should be prepared for it. So I guess I'll...
Questions?
Yeah.
Questions, and also we have some people who want to show you their work.
Okay. Okay, that'll be great.
Should we talk about the chat? Put the thing up again on the screen for anybody who wants to ask.
Okay.
Were you going to also talk about your personal work that you were doing?
Anybody who wants to log into Yahoo Instant Messenger can go ahead.
Which one should I do?
Type in Chen chat.
Me. Should I show my work
questions
now? Or
yeah, I'll show you work quick.
And then, okay.
And then we'll look at some of the student
work. Okay. Sorry, I'm not. This interface totally just, I just suddenly feel like I'm totally ignorant. How do I get to the, let me see, okay, portfolio here. Let me see, okay, let me show you live drawings, okay, my live drawings. What is that? Oh, wait, okay, live drawings, okay. This is, yeah, live drawing is, yeah. I don't know if you guys still do, I mean, you must have classes, right? Live drawing should be a continuously training for yourself. You should keep doing it. At Cal Arts, I do live drawing every single day. You know, except Saturday and Sunday because there's no models there. If there's a model there, I always there. So my personal experience told me that never draw 8 hours in one day, but do 1 hour in 8 days. I think it's going to work better, because if you draw 1 hour each day, that, I mean, not eight, okay, that's 7 days, okay, you do 1 hour every single day, I think the effect, and you're going to make more improvement than do 7 hours in a day. Because when you do it, it's like you brush your teeth and it's like you're driving a car to work. You do it every day, and then it becomes your second nature. And your brain is so used to it, and it's just become part of you. It works better that way. And that's my experience. So yeah, here you learn a lot about, you know, those, you know, and also about, you know, how to make, you know, great drawings. Anyway, this is my live drawings, and yeah, this is all, what should I say? Okay, yeah, this one is maybe worth saying something, yeah. See, this is a very difficult, like, angle to do. It's all about foreshortening, and not only you have to understand construction and anatomy, but also know how, you know, those principles I just told you, overlapping and kind of achieve a plan that would trick the audience eye thinking, okay, it's going that way. And most of all, it's about gesture, okay? This is all, let me see. Yeah, you know, things like that, it's very rough, you know, like this line here. I just draw that because I don't have time that, but it's okay. You know, everything is pretty much there. And, oh yeah, like this. This is actually, I don't like this part. Again, remember that those are reverse S-curve I was talking about. Yeah, it doesn't quite work here for me, so I thought it should be pushed a little bit more. And yeah, gesture, please. Wait, it doesn't go. Oh, this is the last one. Oh, sorry. Actually, I have more drawings in my portfolio than here because there's some problem digitizing my thing, so that's it for the live drawing, and back. Then let me show you some Milan development work, character development. Okay, this is one of it. This is an imperial announcer. Again, you know, make sure that you do things that has a caricature quality to it. And notice the use of color. This is Mushu. Yeah. Again, try to incorporate that, the Moulin theory into it, you know, that big S-curve motif. You know, try to bring that into the character. Yeah, this is one of the early designs of Mushu. Emperor, the same thing. And, okay, little girls. Yeah, again, you know, S-curve everywhere. That is the style of the film, yeah. And again, this is very early ones. At that time, I was still trying to figure out what makes Chinese art look Chinese. I don't even know what it is, so. You know, this is actually an interpretation of an ancient painting. So I just go over it with a sense of cartooning and kind of make those ancient paintings into cartoons and try to find out, you know, if anything I can copy from them. Steal from them. And this is Han Chieftain. Oh, yeah. I don't know. I was told, you know, who said that? Anyway, I think one artist said, good artists, what does he say? Oh, good artists copy and great artists steal. And yeah, after years of practicing this, and I realized this is very true. See, this is the same subject, but two totally different approach. This one is more graphic. The one before is more atmospheric. Okay. Thank you. And this is more like production design. This is very toward the end of production, so it's pretty tight. And this is what they use in the film. But yeah, because of the coloring, I always like to, you know, because the Han soldiers, yeah, they have their head shaved. So kind of bluish, but because of some production, you know, reality concern, yeah, we would run out of money, so we never do that. And Han horse, oh yeah, this is done like during the very early stage of the development. It was finalized in a very early stage of the production because it was a CGI scene, you know, that Han charge scene, they need a horse. So it has to be finalized and decided, you know, when other characters are still kind of in the mist. So this is one of them. And the idea is to make Mulan's horse more like elegant, you know, Chinese-looking, you know, bulky, you know, fergana type of horse. While Han horse is more those, you know, kind of wild horse type, you know, they look actually more like dogs than horse. And that's the idea. We want the horse to look kind of, and horse is a vegetarian, but we want this Han horse to look, you know, kind of menacing and almost like a T-Rex like. So you can see, you know, the head is totally stylized and very squarish, and the teeth are like really pronounced, and so they almost can bite, you know, like dogs. And the body type is the same thing, the legs are shorter, so, and the bodies are longer. That's the idea. I don't know how good it turned out to the audience. And again, this is a copy of an ancient painting, and try to learn something from it. So finally, I learned something. I thought it was that elegant quality of S-curve in it. So it's no big deal, but I was so full of myself. Okay, so I tried to make it a great, you know, a prominent, you know, graphic, you know, statement. So everything is curvy. Everything is so S-curve. And this is one early design of the main ancestor. It's actually pretty close to the final design. Oh yeah. Oh, I forgot to mention that. When you, as a designer, yeah, you have to work with animators. Never expect that animator will be able to draw and animate the way you expect it, because everybody draw different. It's like asking me to draw like your style. It just feels uncomfortable. And as a designer, I don't want to hinder the animator's ability to perform, to act. So I like them to feel comfortable as well. So during this process, there's a lot of back and forth. Okay, I do the design and I give it to the animator. I say, okay, draw it and animate. You know, do some test animation and then I'll look, and then they'll come back to me, and then they will draw something that is just totally off, and I'll say, no. Do this, and so there's a lot of back and forth, and so eventually they found something. So it never be the way you want it. Okay, in a studio situation, it's always that you have to work out a compromise. You think that you haven't sacrificed your integrity, but other people can feel comfortable about it. So obviously you see, you know, it's still different, look different from the final design. Because, you know, the animator has to be able to draw comfortably so they can act. Matchmaker?
We have a question from
okay.
Liquid Dynamics.
Okay.
He wants to know, who were your greatest influences?
My greatest influences? Oh, my God. Yeah, that's my first inspiration. I would say many. I'll try to answer this question. I never thought about it. But I would say, yeah, commercially, I would say Bruce. Yeah, Bruce Timm would be my greatest influence on my work. But before that, I would say I don't even know the names, because I growing up watching tons of cartoons, and I like a lot of them. And a lot of Japanese animation, yeah. Some of them is designed by Osamu Tezuka. And of course, Disney films and Melco stuff. And I don't really have a specific artist I'm obsessed with, but I'm pretty eclectic. So yeah, I like a lot of artists that for different reasons. And as you can see, for my early work, later, if you guys got a chance, yeah, flip through my portfolio, then you'll see my I change styles myself as well, and I think I'm pretty flexible. I can do very realistic stuff, and I can do cartoony stuff too. And working in a commercial world, I think it's very important that you are flexible. You know, you can do, you know, realistic stuff, and also you can do cartoony stuff, and it's better that way. And Mulan. And yeah, you'll see something that I had shown before in this early design. As I said, you know, those loose pins. This is Mulan. You saw that? Yeah, this is one of the costume design. This is different. Yeah, this one is different from the one I saw you. But they all have very similar, you know, structure. That one, you saw that, and there's Chinese zodiac creatures. Mushu used to be one. I mean, eventually in the film, it wasn't very clear. The original idea is on the family temple, there's 12 animals. You know those Chinese, you know, zodiac creatures. There are 12 of them, and Mushu was one of them, but he was demoted. And so this is, you know, so there's a rat, ox, a tiger, and yeah, eventually, you know, there's also a boar. And so yeah, they're kind of cute, and they're kind of all naughty creatures, and Mushu was one of them. But eventually they thought it's very distracting, so they cut all those animals except Mushu. And yeah, some ideas for, you know, some continuity ideas for, oh, that's the one you saw. Some early ideas of the soldiers. And, oh, yeah, this elephant, yeah, this was cut from the film. In the end, in the parade sequence, you know, the soldiers walk into the Imperial Palace, you know, there's a parade. Originally, yeah, there will be a parade of, you know, like with elephants, you know. This is very typical in ancient China. But what I want you to see here in this drawing is the styling of this elephant, because I'm going to show you another elephant drawing for Tarzan that is totally different. Okay, here this elephant is more, I mean, obviously this is the Asian elephant, and I try to make it more graceful. And And let me see. Okay, so see, again, everything is S-curve, you know, everything is so, kind of silky, very flowing, has, you know, elegant. Oh, I guess that's it. So that's some development work. And also, okay, sketches. This is our story sketches. That is, but it's different from the storyboarding. Storyboard, okay. This is more like illustration, who I want to quickly kind of illustrate a certain situation. So on Mulan, we used to have a betrothal sequence, you know, where, you know, Mulan's parents meet with Shane's parents. And yeah, it was cut, because it's obviously, you know, kind of very, it dragged the story. Early, some quick ideas of the village, Mulan's village, and the family temple. Yeah, it used to be a huge one. But later we found out it's just too big. It's not very private. It's not a private place that Mulan would go there and feel, you know, secure and pray for the ancestors. Or we were thinking about a ruin where you see a lot of statues there. And again, for the village, and this is some visualization for the battle, some Shan Yu ideas, you know, some staging ideas for Shan Yu's appearance. Shan Yu, this is after the avalanche sequence. And, oh yeah, and then this is to quickly get idea for the scene that Mulan fight against Shan Yu.
Are these in pencil or charcoal?
Pencil. It's actually very small. It's about probably just this. It's just about this big. Uh-huh. Actually, probably smaller than that. It just quickly get some ideas. Yeah, and the mood and atmosphere. And originally, we have a chubby emperor, you know, kind of Santa Claus looking emperor, kind of happy and kind of a bit dumb, and we have a guy called General Wu, who is a traitor, and who arranged the Han, invasion actually, and the Han assassin. So this is one of the early visualization that the Han actually disguised themselves, yeah, underneath the dancing dragons, and just some visual ideas. They might jump out from the mouth of the dragon. And at that time, we have a character called Bao Gang, who is actually the captain of the Chinese army, and who tried to save the emperor from the attacking Huns. Bao Gang later was reduced in size and become Yao. And character totally changed. Okay, Bao Gang used to be just a very typical, straight, you know, restricted, you know, those, imagine those, you know, those army colonel, you know, those sergeant, you know, they're stiff and they're very demanding, you know, shout at the soldiers, you know, to the face all the time, that kind of character. But yeah, later he was cut out, and later, you know, we came out this idea of a gang of three, and so he got changed, right? That's a big change, right? And then Yao becomes a comical character and short and more like a bulldog. And that's totally different. And yeah, some situations, yeah, like this idea, yeah, eventually it was realized in the final film, but of course, staged different. Can you see that way? Yeah. Okay, this is Han with the hawk. It's just a visual idea. Yeah, at that time, I think the Shan Yu, oh yeah, the reason why he's doing that. There's some early ideas that Shan Yu has some magical power. He actually is more like a wizard. So he has magic, he can do bad things to people. But later we thought, wow, that is getting too much like what would you have seen in the past, you know, from Disney films. And this one, just visuals. I guess that's it. Let me see. Okay. Sketches. Okay. Some Tarzan character design. Some of the design for the apes. Yeah, they are apes, but I just try to give them as much variations as I can. You know, cute ones, big ones, and smaller ones, whatever. And you saw that. again. Oh, this is, see? Wow, how many these characters I designed? Anyway, I must have done like 30 of, you know, a bunch of the gangs, just 30 of them. And they have to look all different. So this is, again, most of them are inspired by those photographs of bikers. And this is actually from Mulan's art director, Rick Struder. Remember him?
Yeah, the weaponry and the swords are pretty exotic.
Oh, yeah.
Have they helped you with that?
Oh, great, yeah. I have a book of those, you know, African throwing knives.
Yeah.
You know, they all look, I just can't believe it. To me, they are not weapon. They look like art to me. It's just great, you know, really beautiful, great, you know, graphic design to me. But I heard it's pretty fatal.
APM said the only ones allowed to use those.
Here we go. Yeah, but we are not doing our job. And yeah, this is, you know, this the same set of characters, and I hope, you know, they all look different to you. And you saw that. Okay, this is the elephant. Oh, this is for Tarzan. So remember that elephant I showed you from Mulan? It's more elegant, more, you know, reserved. This elephant is more like a ruffian. You know, I don't know how many fights he had been into. You know, the tusk is broken, you know, ear had been torn. And he's old, but he's still pretty stubborn. And it's a support fight. Oh, you saw that. Jane, you saw that. You saw that. Here we go. Yeah, you saw. Okay, I guess that's it. Yeah. Okay. Back. Let me see what else. Mona theory, you know that. Yeah, that's pretty much it. I mean, there's more in my portfolio, so if you got a chance, you know, flip through it. And any questions?
Yeah, questions, and then we'll look at a couple of students.
Okay. All right.
Any questions here in the audience before?
Oh.
At the beginning, you said that that there aren't really any character design positions available, and usually, if you're applying for a studio, you're going to apply as in the visual development department.
No, I didn't say. I did not say there's no character design position available. No. I don't mean that. I mean there's no really such a category. For job classification,
right.
Usually it's just someone in the visual development department. They just stand out as a more like a character designer.
Okay.
Yeah. When you apply a job, there's no such a category.
Right. So what I was going to ask is, if applying for a job, mm-hmm. how do you tailor like a portfolio for the visual design department? I mean, if there's not,
putting more character stuff. Yeah, in the review board, yeah, they will see and they know. When I look at like this morning, when I look at the student's work, yeah, I can tell that, yeah, this student is more tend toward animation because it seems that he really enjoyed doing, you know, gesture and things like that. And there's characters. I mean, there's also a student who's more into. You can see, you know, that he's more into graphic design because it's of shape, you know, things like that. And so, I mean, we can tell. But of course, it's your decision, and it's your choice to whether which department you like to be in. Yeah, and yeah, if you want to be a character designer, ultimately, yeah, just apply for visual development. In general, visual development, and put your portfolio with not only character design but also situation drawings. You know. Drawings, you see character, you know, interaction, and storyboard, and also illustrations that tell a story. That's very important, you know, because we have a lot of visual development artists who are from the illustration background, you know, who are really inspiring, you know, like Peter did say, you know, who is a kind of big time illustrator, yeah. You know, just artists who can basically illustrate story ideas, yeah. And then, yeah, certain people tend to be categorized as, okay, he does character better, and he does background better, yeah. But ideally, it's the same job. Yeah. As you can see, my portfolio, I don't just do characters. I also do, you know, story situations, you know, scene. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sure.
We have a question from Liquid Dynamics again. How does Chen Yi go about deciding what type of shapes to use in designing his characters and environments?
In the environment? Wow. I guess it's, if you have examples, that would be great. Then we can talk about it. What kind of shapes? I don't have rules for that. Usually it's just go. I just go by experience. And see, this part I cannot, all the rules I told you, you know, you can totally forget about it. Once you know and practice it for years, you know, then you can totally forget about it. You know, a lot of rules, they were there, they meant to be, you know, broken, as I said. And so there's no, you know, a way of seeing it. It basically, you know, art to a certain degree, it's really get into that metaphysical level that I just cannot, I just don't know myself, and I'm learning it myself. That part I cannot tell you. You know, how should I put it? You know, it's all based on experience and your own taste and your own judgment. And now when I look back at films I had done before, I see so many mistakes, and I saw so many things that I should have insist on, and I shouldn't have give up on some ideas, or I shouldn't have done that stupid thing. You know, and some characters I design, some works really well and some works horribly. But hopefully only me know about it. And I just hope that audience wouldn't notice that. And so this is very personal. I really don't know how to answer, you know, this question. But I would say through experience, I think you would know better. Hopefully that answers it.
I remember this morning you mentioned about shapes that have cultural influences, shapes you see normally in Chinese art or Italian art. Would those be...
Did I say that?
Yeah. You don't remember?
I think I'm talking about shapes that tend to have some emotional... I'm talking about the basic shape. Okay, rounder tend to look cute and soft and comfortable, and triangle is more, you know, dynamic, danger. You know, there's some emotion or psychological things that attach to it. And square tends to make you feel secure. You know, it's block and it's heavy. Yeah, but I don't think it has cultural, like, undertone to it. Unless you are talking about those graphic elements that tend to appear a lot in certain culture. You know, like in Mayan art, you know, you see a lot of, you know, swirling, you know, graphic element in it. Then, if you recognize that, then you should try your best to apply that to the film. Oh, speaking of that, that'll be a good example. What is that film? That film that DreamWorks did?
El Dorado.
Oh, El Dorado, yeah. See, the story, okay. Now we just talk about visuals, okay? I thought the visual is really well designed, personally. Okay, you can totally disagree with me, that's fine. I just thought, you know, they find those elements and they really play with it. I thought it works very well for me, visually, yeah. Yeah, as to what shape goes to certain culture, as I say, you know, those archetypes, you know, I believe it apply to, you know, to all human beings, and I don't think there's a cultural, you know, association to that. I mean, maybe I'm just ignorant. I didn't know that. Maybe I should go home and do more homework.
Yeah. Sounded good this morning. Okay. Any other questions?
Okay.
What was the reason for the change of color in the villains, the white garb that they were wearing? You said, and then it eventually changed. I was just curious as to
which
why,
villain
for Tarzan.
Oh, for Tarzan.
Why the that group of pirates that you showed us that were all wearing white? Why did they change that, or why did you put them in white in the beginning? Because white is usually a color associated with like a hero.
I wish I can answer you, but I cannot because I don't know. Right. And I just know that eventually, you know, that film go through, just like every Disney film, you know, that film go through, you know, some big personnel changes. And when the new guys comes in, he probably, you know, don't like the idea that was there. And so he just do the way he feel like to. And if the director kind of agree with that, then that's how it does. Yeah.
Was there a reason at the beginning that you were told as to why they were in white? Did the director say to you, because remember you said that you liked the director's idea as to why it was that, you know, they were dressed in white and that.
Yeah.
But what did the director tell you, or did he tell you why it was white?
Oh.
Like, why did he choose that color?
They didn't tell me why, but I think there's a conversation between the directors and me. And I know why. I can tell you that. But it's not like what the director told me. It's just, I thought it's a good idea because lighter color, white, it will make a big contrast against the apes. Apes are, they all have brownish, you know, darker color. And in this film, they want to do something totally opposite to what we are familiar with. We usually associate with light, with, you know, goodness. But this one, we want to have darker things represent goodness. And the bright things, or like the clear in the forest, tend to represent, you know, things that make people uncomfortable, you know, too bright, you know, just, I thought, wow, we never tried that before, you know, that's a good idea, first. Second, it make a good contrast, you know, when you have this, you know, the European, you know, this thugs comes into this setting. Remember, this is African jungle, it's organic. Everything is kind of greenish, and then if you have this white, you know, like man-made, you know, clothes, things like that, I think it would make a good contrast. And this is very subjective. This is just, I just like the idea, and the directors, they are on the same line as well, and I thought we should give it a try, see how we can work into the audience's mind and really play this out. And then eventually the story take over and the art director just totally ignore it and just do what he feel comfortable with. Yeah. You know, like some of the color design, actually I talked to the art director about that. And the art director and I were good friends. And I talked to him, of course he got offended a little bit. You know, after they did the first pass of the characters, and Jin was in, Chen, the hero was in the yellow dress. And I thought it was horrible. And I told him that, because against, remember what, she appeared in not the first sequence, but the second sequence. The background is all the yellowish bamboo forest. And I thought it's just, Jen as a character just blend into a character. It doesn't stand out. I always thought Jen should be in that kind of, paler color, white. Especially after I saw a film called set in Australia, I believe called the Picnic on the Hanging Rock.
Yeah, Picnic at Hanging Rock.
Oh, at the Hanging Rock. And I thought that film is just visually, there's some element I thought was so inspiring. You see a bunch of, you know, Victorian, you know, dressed woman in white. They were in this, you know, this like never touched, you know, place. How should I describe that feeling? It's a very primitive natural environment. It just feel like they were totally out of place, and it has a very surreal quality to it. It's like in Piano, you know, the movie Piano. You put a piano, it's so handmade, so refined. You put it on the beach, you know, in the movie Piano. It's like so weird, and it does have an emotional impact on the audience. It's like, what is that? And, you know, I just thought that it's a good idea, we should try. But we never got a chance to try. Yeah.
Well, why don't we start looking at some, any work anyone wants to volunteer to bring up their work?
Going to do a little who says here, essentially what it is whenever we have a speaker come, we always have students bring their work if they can, and when we get a chance, have students show their work to whoever the professional is. And we call it a Who Says. It's students testing out their ideas with some experts and some people who have more experience and seeing what they think. And so anytime you come in the future, bring some work and get some comments.
Oh, I forgot to mention, you know, I really reserve myself to answer your question. For some, how come, you know, some ideas sound so great, but how come it never got realized? You know, okay, I just cannot hold it, so okay. You know, at the studio system, okay, it's not your art, okay? A lot of people, they want to have their hands in the making of it. And depends on how much power you have. The more you have, of course, the more you can do, you know, what you want. And in a studio system, yeah, it's never be what you want. It's always what everybody wants. So, yeah.
It's so, like being a French horn player in a big orchestra.
Yeah. Yeah. You have to play according to the score. You might have, you know, French horn, you know, you might be able to do, you know, great, you know, some improvisation, but you just cannot do it. Uh-huh. If you are a jazz player in an orchestra, yeah, you will suffer. So, here we go. So you have to decide if you want to be a team worker or you want to be an independent. Being independent would be great, you know. That used to be what I do, and you don't make money, but you really enjoy being an artist, and you do whatever you want. You're pretty much in total control. In a studio system, yeah, you work for people, yeah. You have to do things quite often you don't really like to do. But hopefully you work out something you still feel happy about. You know, it's a compromise. Yeah.
Okay. Oh. These are ones I showed
you.
Oh,
yes. Earlier. Here we go. Oh, yeah. Okay.
This is basically.
Okay. Hopefully, okay. See that over there? Mm-hmm. Oh, and
yeah, it's this character is a deputy cowboy type. Mm-hmm. He's a Barney Five type-ish. Mm-hmm. He's got this character is basically, he's got a massive ego, but he's really insecure.
Uh-huh.
And guy's kind of clumsy and awkward, and but he thinks he's, you know,
Man. Okay. You say clumsy and awkward, so in that case, you might be able to, you might like to, and this is just a suggestion, you might like to push the contrast of the characters even more, you know, the hands, you can even make it, it's actually big enough, I think, you know, but, you know, like this, you can make it like, you know, he's really almost like a teenager went through his puberty, you know, suddenly things just somehow too big or too, it just grows so fast they don't even know how to control it. And yeah, do you want me? Yeah. Well, how should we do this? Just
draw over it or draw next to it.
Okay. Things like that, I would recommend. You know, there's some. Remember, I said about tension C.
Yeah.
Here's one here. How should I do it? Because then people cannot see what's the drawing. Do you have lighter paper?
No, you'll just have to
anyway.
Side
okay,
to side.
There's a tangency here. Okay. That's what I mentioned earlier. You know, this starts to, you know, here too, yes. So, just for three hands. Okay, I'll just do some short hands so you know what I'm talking about. You know, either make it slightly bigger. Here, this one now. Construct it better. Okay. The fingers start from about this position, okay. The other string is good. And then you might like to try bring this down a little bit. You might like to try this, see if that works. Okay. What I do here is just suggestion. Yeah.
So it looks kind of awkward.
Yeah. And again, make sure, you know, the anatomy feels, you know, yeah, make sure the anatomy looks, you know,
okay,
right. And yeah, I don't know if you want to do that. That's your choice. Yeah, this would be my. Okay, I just give you, you know, big ideas. Again, you know, this, the collar and the shoulder, there's a tangency there. Okay. Did you guys see the difference? You know what I do? You know, those are little things, but that will make it a better drawing, I think. You can go do that. Again, that thing. Yeah. And see if we can pose it, you know, move the hand down a little bit so it's clear. I would do that. Uh-huh.
Explain a little bit about silhouette, too. A lot of students don't realize how powerful silhouette is.
Oh, thank you. See, a lot of things, I start to do it without thinking about it too much. Here's one example. See, when I look at that, I just by instinct, I just feel there's something wrong with it. Okay, and then I can think about it. Oh, okay, it's the tangency, and also, thank you, silhouette. This hand here, I mean, it's sometimes it's inevitable. It will be inside the shape. But in this case, it seems to me that you can easily avoid it. You know, move the hand down a little bit so this finger kind of pop out. That will give the viewer a visual clue of something there. And just move this hand down. That's what I just did, but when you're doing it, I don't think about it anymore. You just know, oh, there's something wrong about it. And like hands here, you know, again, there's this is a tangency. You know, hand goes down here, so you don't know, wait, is the line of the back is also there? I mean, it's just not very well defined. So if you do that, okay, this is the arm, okay, this is the arm, the line for the arm, and then this is for the body. So it's very clear.
And it gives you more three-dimension.
Yeah.
Overlap.
And also, like, the design of the head. Mm-hmm. You know, cowboy head, you know, you saw a lot of cowboy does something to the head, so it doesn't look so, you know, symmetrical like that. You know, they always does something to it. So in this case, if you want to play, see, this depends on personality. This character might do head just like that. He would never touch it. Or he might do something to the head, so the head will start to turn into something more, you know, pleasant. So that would be your choice.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, great. Thanks a lot.
Sure.
Appreciate it.
Wow, there's so many.
Yeah. You want to? Anybody else?
Okay. Yeah, this one is good. Yeah, this is really a good drawing, and everything is great. But why don't you just draw the whole body? If.
Oh yeah, I was just trying to pop them out as many as I could.
Okay. Yeah, the cowboy is doing something, huh? Okay, so. Oh, yeah, okay. Now, remember I say squash and stretch? See, here's an opportunity for you to do that. You see that?
Mm-hmm.
Now, the shape goes parallel. Okay, did you see that? Yeah, to me, that is graphically not very satisfying. So, and okay, and this, how do you call this thing?
It's like a vest.
Oh, vest, okay. The vest, it has its own thing going on, so it won't wrap around. In this case, okay, you have a vest here, this way. Actually, on the other side, you see the vest more like that. I bet. Trust me, put a vest on, it's going to look, you see the inside of the vest on the other side. Okay. Yeah, here would be a good opportunity to do that. So there's a sense of structure underneath. Okay. And again, here, hand goes that way. Yeah, here's the opportunity, as I said, you know, hand. You might want to try that. Move this finger up like that. And here, gesture, I don't know what you want to do, but let me see what you can do with that. I don't know. That's your choice.
Just by adding a pinch and a stretch. Pinch on one side, stretch.
Yeah, mainly I would like to emphasize this thing here. Yeah, this would be your choice. Uh-huh. Or you want to do something totally. You know, that cowboy thing. I don't know. This is your choice. Mm. Or even if you want to do that, even push it further. Or. Yeah, then yeah, this you have to try and see which one you think, because I don't know your character.
Right.
Yeah, this is your character, so you probably know, you know, how much degree you can push, you know, the gesture to. Yeah, but that and the vest, and oh, the fold. Mm-hmm. Okay, let me give you some short hints. I don't know if I should do this. Okay, yeah, you can do that. Okay, this thing wrap around the arm inside. So, yeah, you can do that. This is one way of doing it. Or if you want to do it more with style, you can do that. Or some people just do that. See, then it's a style. It's a, it's your choice.
And you're indicating a form.
Yeah. But I would try to avoid, you know, parallel lines. Like here, you know, see, this parallel line. If you can, you know, more like that, it looks better. It looks more natural. Oh, Alex Toth would even describe the, you know, the some little subtleties there, but forget it.
Okay.
Great.
Thanks.
Thanks a lot.
Okay.
Any other examples? No?
Yeah.
Well, are we still on the...
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Thanks.
Sure.
Why didn't you give him like...
Okay.
I think you need that one.
Okay.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Good. Okay.
I have a couple of character designs.
Oh. I think...
Give him that.
Okay. Where is this? I'm attacked. Okay. Here we go. Oh, that one is done? Oh, sorry. Uh-huh.
Concept.
Okay, good.
Mm-hmm. Playing around with expressions and contrasting these characters.
Okay.
With like another character.
Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah. Good.
Right here.
Yeah, right here. Here's a the close up of the girl he's doing, and here's the full body. Okay. Okay, without knowing the character, I'll just work on the graphics itself. Okay, like this one. Remember, okay, the lips. From what you're doing, I think it's not very cartoony. Remember the lips. This is the lip is the most sexy part of, you know, of a girl's face. You know, make sure that the lips wraps around, okay? Do you see? And then there's, I mean, it's fine here, but if I were you, I would do more, I would straighten this part out. I know this is not necessarily good drawing here, but I just want to illustrate the point. Okay, make sure the lip coming out from here, so you see, remember that. So there's a dimension. Mm-hmm. Oh, I was drawing up there. You know, like this, that plain thing I was talking about, and that sense of depth. You know, this part is longer than that, so it creates a sense of a plane. Okay. Same thing on the lower lips. Okay. So it feels that it's there's a sense, you know, it's there. It's not something just somehow just attached to, you know, to the face. Mm-hmm. And the nose, okay, if you want to do that, see, okay, I would do, see this line, you try to do the plan, but it seems to me the plan should be more like that. This would be the plan. I think the shadow is a bit weird. You know what I'm saying? Okay, this is a bridge. Do you call that bridge?
Yeah.
Okay. Here. Okay, and this two lines should line up well. And then you have the under part of the nostril. How to call this? Anyway, you know what I mean. Yeah, make sure. Did you see that?
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll go over. Make sure it's... This say eye is the window to the soul, and in animation it is also true. So make sure that you can draw eyes very well on the face. Yeah, make sure you can draw eyes very well and the mouth. Okay, make sure it's like dimensional. You still, I know you like to see it slanted, but that's fine. Okay, so make sure it's dimensional.
How did you learn how to draw eyes and mouths? Explain that to the student.
How do I learn?
Yeah.
I don't know. How do I? I would say, just do a lot. You know, a lot of rules I already told you, and a lot of them just by doing a lot of them. You know, my painting teacher told me, and actually my drawing teacher Glenn Vilpu told me the same thing. He said that you have to. To done 1,000 bad drawings, then you will start doing good drawings. And which is true. You know, for my personal experience, it is totally true. You know, I haven't met a genius in my life yet. You know, all the artists I know at the studio, all of them sweat and they work so hard to get, you know, to be who they are today. And and like Allison said, you know, what? 10% of what? Inspiration and 90% of perspiration. See, when I was a kid, I was like, yeah, right, yeah, yeah. But later I learned, yeah, it is totally true, you know. And a lot of people, they say, oh, I want to be a good artist, I want to be a good artist, but then I never seen them draw. They just talk about it and want to be one, but they never really work on it. So how can they be a good artist? You have to do a lot, and trust me, you know, the reason you are artist is because you are different from other people who don't draw. I mean, you draw so many that make you artist, and that would make you a better artist. What I'm talking about. But anyway, yeah, just do a lot. Seriously, it's going to help tremendously. And if you can draw every single day, and same here, the mouse. See if you want definition of that. But that's your. If you want that fuller, make sure, yeah. Again, did you see that? There's a break of line here and here. If you like that fuller mouth. This is just suggestions. And these are little things on the face. And then here's the body. See, I don't know your character. What is she supposed to be? Charming, very attractive, and
no.
No. Okay.
This is more like the charming type.
Okay. So, can you tell me more about her?
She's very to herself. Timid. Quiet. But she's got a kind of an edge to her. Like she can be, because she had like a rough. Life. She does magic. She's she's kind of this different type of girl. But she's not very feminine. She's more
okay. All right. I got a little bit idea of what this character is about. So you already got it here. You know that strong jaw. You say that she's quiet, but she's kind of strong, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now you can play that. You got this character. What I thought is very interesting about this character, visually, I thought it's the jaw here. You might like to play that. You know, make it strong. Really, really make that part, you know, really pronounced. Yeah, so the head is maybe a bit more angular if you want. And again, you know, make here, where, what is that?
She's wearing like a robe, like a cloak.
Oh,
it's kind of tying around here.
How does it tie to the neck? It's just there, you know, like kind of like Superman. It's just there. We don't know how it works.
Well, that, yeah. For now, in this drawing, it's not pronounced.
Oh.
It would be more like, I guess, you know, kind of like that kind of thing.
Oh. Okay. I'm not saying it has to kind of work. I just, it confused me. I thought it's the collarbone, but I guess it's not. So yeah, this is your choice, but just structurally, this girl here, okay, here now you can see, if you like that spiky hair, go for it. Okay, now it's good. Here, work on the structure a little bit so it looks solid. Okay, the breast here, see if you want to, if you like this, give it a little bit definition. And okay, this is that part. I'll let you figure that out yourself. Okay. Here. Again, yeah, this is a bit, this gesture is a bit mechanical, which is fine because it seems to me, as you can see, he's doing a turn around, you know, a mechanical turnaround of the character. But even that, see if you can put something interesting to her. Let me see. Wow, this is a tough one. Okay. Yeah, maybe shift the weight a little bit. But I know you tried to make it straight, so it's just simply a mechanical turn. Okay, again, work on the anatomy a little bit. Okay, do this. See if you want to do that. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I think it will look slightly better this way. Okay, again. Do you see the difference?
Mm-hmm.
Here and here. Yeah. Yeah, it feels, you know, more comfortable to the eyes. And this, I don't know if that's because of the costume. See, it's all like two parallel lines. Is that because of, this is the costume?
Which one? Yeah.
Here, the lower arm.
There's two lines?
Yeah, there's two lines. So it's because of costume or it's just the way you draw? Because if I were you, for such a, that's why I say I have to, see, I would do more like that. And then you put your hand here. But if that's part of costume, then make it clear. Either it's going this way, or you know what I'm saying? Or it should slightly taper into the wrist and to the okay. Then just make it clear that you know it kind of become bigger toward the wrist, and then you should see. It seems to me you should see. Okay, again. You should see part of the hand, and then the cloak. Oh, it's about this long. Yeah, this would be what I would do. Yeah, and again, I would say work on the anatomy and construction a little bit because the whole anatomy looks kind of strange to me. You know like the head seems to me more like that.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't look very natural to me unless you do it on purpose. That's what you want. You know, like this head here. Okay. I would do that. Okay, you got a neck here, skull. Okay. this is the back, and then goes up. And remember the definition of that, of the breast. Can you guys see over there? Okay. Shoulder. Okay, definition of the that the belly, and then leg comes out this way. Okay, again, that S curve I was talking about, it looks, this looks more right than that. Okay, so yeah, the rest is pretty much the same. Yeah, yeah, just work on the construction. It seems to me, yeah, it's not very well constructed. You know, the head is not connected to the torso, right? And let me see. Yeah, and when you are drawing, make sure that you really understand the form. Yeah, this is more like a drawing problem here. You know, understand this thing going on in the drawing. Do you know what I'm doing?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean the volume. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the construction. Link this up, that'll be characters. Yeah. Yeah, work on the construction. This seems to me. Yeah, the reason why animator, you know, like to use, you know, those basic construction element, you know, like, you know, a circle, things like, it's just easy for a lot of people to follow, and it's easy to understand. You know, they, you know, remember those, you know, formulaic, you know, drawings, you know, they would draw something like that and do that, you know, things like this thing. You know, like when they draw Mickey Mouse, you know, this is how they construct it, you know, that this thing, you know, that there's a reason for this to be, you know, to be there. It's just, you know, there's a process, and people, all the drawers can understand. And so when you are doing a model, and you know, after you've done all the homework and you design it, then when it seems to me, see, like this is almost like a production model sheet, then work on the construction so it looks right. Mm-hmm. And people can follow. Otherwise, it seems to me it's just kind of over the place.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
We'll try and open yours up.
Thank you. Yeah, our last.
One more.
Okay.
This one?
Okay.
Yeah. You don't mind going through it, sir?
Oh, wow. Wow, this is overwhelming. That's a lot. Should I share this with everybody? Okay. I think you are more like from illustrations or fine art background. Okay, I kind of know. You know what? For animation, especially for commercial world, you might need to work on the character in a more analytical way instead of kind of just go by your feeling and emotion. It should be more constructive. If you know what I mean, you know, instead of just drawing the house, you really know where the bricks are. I mean, I shouldn't say that. Not the bricks, but I mean where, you know, the beams and the columns are. I should say that. You know, the bigger things like that, you know, it's very personal. And if you like animation, maybe you should develop, you know, yourself into independent, if that's what you like. If you want to work in a commercial world, then you need to develop make your drawing solid. You know what I'm saying? You know, drawings that looks, that have weight and have, you know, and people can see, you know, the draftsmanship and you know, attitude, instead of just a beautiful, you know, like lines, you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Yeah, things like that, I just don't know how to comment on it. Yeah. Yeah, this is very, very personal. Nothing wrong with that. If this is the direction you like to go, I can only just say, you know, keep going. And but if you want to work on the commercial world, I think you have to change your mentality a little bit. And are you willing to do that, to make that change?
I'm getting more abstract.
Oh, you're getting more abstract?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
See, and I'm sorry, I'm not a fine artist, and I'm not into the fine art, so I really cannot comment on your work, because I'm a commercial animation artist. Yeah, so that's what I know best. Things like that.
It's like a different situation. It's like putting Louis Armstrong in the Philharmonic. It's like, he could probably do it, but he wouldn't be happy. And the thing is, and the conductor would be less happy with him when he did a riff in the middle of the thing that wasn't planned. So they're two different worlds.
Mm-hmm. So.
And that's all the time we have for today. Thanks, Chen Yi, for coming down.
Yeah.
Thank you all. And hopefully the notes help. And
really great day. Thanks a lot
for
sticking with us. Okay. And everyone who came online with us for the webcast, thanks for joining us. But for now, that's it.
Yeah.